stop at the Branch Davidian compound outside Waco, Texas. Chairing the joint hearing, Republican Bill Zeliff of New Hampshire and Republican Bill McCollum of Florida. This part of the event runs 3.5 hours.
We're back. This hearing will come to order. This is the second day of the joint hearings between the two subcommittees of Reform and Oversight and Judiciary. Today, I have the opportunity and the pleasure to host this hearing in the Judiciary Committee meeting rooms. Tomorrow, my co-chairman, Bill Zeliff, will host the hearings in his setting. And from now on, for the remainder of the 7 days or so that we're doing these hearings, there will be the alternative back and forth. To lay the ground rules for today, there will be 4 opening statements permitted of 5 minutes each in length by the two chairs and the two ranking members of the subcommittees. We're not going any further with those, and they'll be very brief and to the point. I am only going to make a couple of minutes of opening statements and yield for about 2 or 3 minutes to my good friend, Mr. Booyer, and I'm going to make that statement at this point in time, so we'll begin the clock, so we'll run it fairly for everybody involved.
Mr. Chairman.
Yesterday's, in a moment, it'll be an order.
Parliamentary inquiry.
Yes, Mr. Lantos.
Mr. Chairman, at what point may one raise questions about the procedures?
The procedures will come up after the opening statements because we have to ask unanimous consent each day to begin the process.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome. Yesterday we had quite an opening day, and I think that you saw quite a bit of why we're having these hearings yesterday. You had quite a graphic picture painted of what was going on in the Branch Davidian compound. You had some very strong statements made that paint a picture of David Koresh in less than flattering terms. And I don't think any member of this panel on either side of the aisle had any false impressions before we started these hearings, and we certainly don't today, that David Koresh was an outstanding citizen or that he did the right thing in what he did in his actions at Waco. But we did need to lay that predicate. But in addition to that, yesterday, what I think is really important to these hearings is not the emotion of how he mistreated people, potentially, or young girls inside that compound, though that is important, not to necessarily to what we're after in these hearings, other than to lay the predicate. What is really important is what is being done or was being done by the ATF and law enforcement and whether the conduct of the raid was appropriate. During the course of the day yesterday, we got quite a bit of testimony involving the questions of how they initially got involved in this process, the questions of whether they really were intent upon arresting David Koresh before they did the actual raid on the 28th of February, and whether or not indeed the final aspect of all of this before the raid was conducted was sanctioned properly by the Treasury Department. And there are real questions that are still out there lingering from the end of the day yesterday about Treasury's role, about the accuracy of the report that Treasury put out, about a lot of the facts and the details about what really happened. Today we'll go through the planning stages. We've got 4 panels of witnesses. Tomorrow we'll do the raid itself. We'll have plenty of opportunity to go into these questions. Today, though, because he's going to be a lead questioner, I'm going to yield the balance of my time to the gentleman from Indiana, Mr. Booyer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. With regard to the military involvement in Waco, when you've examined a lot of the investigative reports, there really isn't a lot with regard to the military involvement. I think the image of the Bradley fighting vehicles, M1 tanks, set against the burning Mount Carmel compound calls into question the role of the military in Waco and that of local law enforcement. Since that time, there has been a rapid speculation concerning the level of involvement of the U.S. Armed Forces and the National Guard in support of local enforcement during the planning execution of the initial ATF raid in February 1993, as well as during the siege and the final assault 51 days later. Since before the founding of our nation, Americans have deeply rooted concerns about the separation of the military from civilian affairs. In the Declaration of Independence, Thomas Jefferson lists among his grievances that the king had, quote, affected to render the military independent of and superior to the civil power, end quote. Our Constitution addresses these issues, providing for civilian control of the military and assigning the president a dual role as chief executive officer and commander-in-chief of the military. The Constitution also provides for a well-regulated militia, today known as the National Guard, which is subject to regulation by the Congress and controlled by the President in his role as Commander-in-Chief when those forces are federalized. In 1878, the Congress passed the Posse Comitatus Act, which prohibited, unless otherwise authorized by the Constitution or Congress, the use of any part of the Army to enforce the laws of the land. Interestingly, it did so in response to accusations of at least 2 Republican state governments in the South were in power only because of their presence of federal forces. That statute remains in force today and is at issue at Waco. Over the years, Congress has made exceptions to the Posse Comitatus Acts, particularly in the area of military support of the war on drugs. However, many would be surprised today when they learn that there was a great deal of military support can be obtained by local law enforcement without making a drug connection. Many would also be surprised to learn that the National Guard, when under state control and receiving federal funds, is exempt from the Posse Comitatus statute. The helicopters that supported the ATF during the initial raid were flown by members of the Texas National Guard. The purpose of this panel is to determine the role of the active duty military and the National Guard in the initial planning and execution of the ATF raid on February 28, 1993. Did the military overstep the bounds of the Posse Comitatus statute and provide inappropriate training prior to the raid? Were U.S. military forces directly involved in the planning and execution of the raid? Answering these questions will help bolster America's trust in the military and federal law enforcement. But we need to seek a larger purpose. Because of the nation's deeply rooted concerns about separating the military from civilian affairs, we need to review the manner in which the military can legally provide support to local law enforcement and federal law enforcement. Has Congress gone too far and allowed too many exceptions to the Posse Comitatus statute? What is the proper role of the military and law enforcement? Should we further restrict law enforcement access to the vast capabilities that our military has to offer? These are valid questions that need to be reviewed in the aftermath of Waco. I would like to thank all of the panelists and many who have traveled a long way to testify. I know that many who will testify today, specifically members of the team that trained the ATF, have been hounded by many, and that we will make sure that hopefully all of the information and the truth comes out today. Thank you. I yield back the balance of my time. Okay.
At this time, I recognize the gentleman from New York, Mr. Schumer, for 5 minutes. Parliamentary inquiry, Mr. Taylor? Yes.
Mr. Chairman, yesterday we made a request of the chair that four additional witnesses be brought forward to give us a full accounting of the events that led up to the raid on Waco. They were the authors of the series, The Sinful Messiah. It was the woman who claims to have been held captive by Koresh for 3 months against her wishes. The woman who claims Koresh compiled a hit list to murder ex-members.
Mr. Taylor, if you work through your minority leadership, that request has never been made to me by either of the minority leaders.
Sir, I made it on television in front of this committee yesterday, and you said you would take care of it.
I said we would explore it with your minority leadership. I don't know if I was in the chair, Mr. Zellup, but we said we would explore it, and we will explore it. You have made the point again today, and we will explore it. We have not agreed to do anything, but we will explore it.
In fairness to those members of this committee who want to know the events leading up to it, when will that decision be made?
I do not know, Mr. Taylor. It will be made. I would probably sometime later today, but we've not had a break. As you know, we ran the hearings last night until very late, till 11 o'clock. We got into a discussion with some of your leadership last night after we ran this hearing, and we reconvened this morning without having gotten together to discuss it among ourselves in any other way. That was not part of the discussion. I will take it under consideration today. We need to proceed in regular order today.
Mr. Chairman,
I'm sorry you're not...
Then we deserve the opportunity to vote on whether or not to subpoena those witnesses.
You can always have a reservation of those opportunities.
Mr. Chairman, can I assure my colleague that we will bring this matter from the minority leadership to the attention
you certainly may.
Chair immediately.
Thank you. Mr. Schumer for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And first, let me begin by saying
John, I can't hear myself.
Okay. Let me begin by saying once again that these hearings into the 1993 events at Waco can be very useful. I think they got off to a powerful start yesterday. We heard from 14-year-old Kiri Jewell, who described how she was raped at the age of 10 by David Koresh. She told us there was widespread sexual abuse within the Branch Davidian compound. She also explained Koresh's instructions on how to commit suicide, quote, put the gun into your mouth, back to the soft spot above your throat, before pulling the trigger. We also heard from Ray Yan, the assistant U.S. attorney in Texas, who told us that the Davidians were armed with machine guns and believed that, quote, in order to die for God, they had to be able to kill for God, unquote. While listening to Kiri Jewell was difficult, it was critically important for us here in our suits, sitting behind this dais, to know what the women and men of law enforcement were faced with at Waco. David Koresh was armed to the teeth with machine guns, he raped 10-year-old girls, and he had visions of mass destruction. Some have the gall, to ask what the testimony we heard yesterday had to do with law enforcement's decision. That's like asking, what does ethnic cleansing have to do with decisions in Bosnia? Everything. These are difficult problems that do not always end up the way we want them to. Yet as feeling and caring people, we feel we must act. Law enforcement moved because they could not allow other Kiri Jewels, who were still inside the compound, to continue to suffer. Remember, the ATF and FBI had to act quickly, on the spot. They didn't have the benefit we have of hindsight. Today we're going to hear about some serious mistakes made by the ATF. But they were not made maliciously or as part of some evil conspiracy, as some would have you believe. They made the mistakes because they heard the cries of the Kiri Jewels inside the compound. They heard the screams of the little kids being beat up by David Koresh with a wooden boat oar. The plan to enter the compound, however flawed its execution, was only made after careful planning and discussed down to the tiniest minutia. Let's get to the bottom of what caused the initial raid to go bad. But let us not forget that it ultimately went awry because of the evil of David Koresh.
Mr. Zeloff, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Today we resume a joint congressional hearing into executive branch conduct regarding the events at Waco, Texas in 1993. Yesterday we heard from 17 witnesses who described various aspects of the investigation and warrants leading up to the February 28th assault on the Branch Davidian compound by the ATF. We heard from authors, former Davidians, lawyers who prosecuted surviving Davidians, ATF agents, ATF commanders, and former high-level ATF officials. As the 8 days of hearings of this tragedy unfold, we will hear from a total of 93 witnesses, and we will question them all. Whatever else we argue about, we have worked very hard with the minority to meet their needs relative to witnesses and equal access to the truth. And I believe that we all want to know what happened at Waco and why. During these hearings, our eyes must be fixed on our truth-seeking and our oversight function as to what happened at Waco. These hearings are not just about NRA or 14-year-old girls. They are about oversight of ATF, FBI, and Department of Defense. In a nutshell, finding out the truth is the essence of oversight, and constitutional oversight, as I said yesterday, is part of the genius of our democracy, the checks and the balances. Getting to the bottom of things, especially complicated and tragic things, takes a major commitment. We have that commitment, and so far I think we are slowly making progress. While we may all agree, and I think we do, that David Koresh is not a nice person, we discovered a number of important facts yesterday. In addition to hearing disturbing and graphic testimony from a 14-year-old on the topic of child abuse, and more important about how David Koresh did live, we learned the following. First, ATF agents testified for the first time that they actually refused an invitation by David Koresh to come and examine Koresh's firearms long before the deadly raid and that which followed. This new testimony corroborates for the first time the account also heard in the room yesterday of the Waco firearms dealer who knew Koresh. In short, we knew that ATF, for reasons that may have seemed sound at the time, rejected an early alternative to the raid. It simply was not pursued. Second, we discovered that legal experts share certain criticisms of the search warrant ATF intended to serve on Koresh. Putting aside the arrest warrant, which might have been served on Koresh at a place outside the compound, we learned that the search warrant was filled with, quote, inflammatory language and was generally, quote, sloppy and may have contained factual inaccuracies. Third, we learned that the ATF gave little or no attention to doing a knock and serve entry. ATF testified that siege planning began in December and formal raid planning began in January. As the committee heard yesterday, the raid plan kept gathering steam, even though a social worker who was investigating child abuse was only permitted to enter was openly permitted to enter the compound. Again, a viable option seems to have been underutilized, perhaps prematurely rejected. Fourth, the Waco deputy sheriff testified that despite ATF's and FBI's request for substantial military assistance based on a supposed drug connection, an alleged drug lab within the compound, the sheriff had never seen and had no knowledge of any drug lab. This raises serious questions that today's panels will address shortly. Fifth, we learned that one of the surviving Davidians believes, although ATF does not, that ATF-guided helicopters shot through the roof of the compound. He also testified that he never saw child abuse, although we did receive contrary and graphic testimony from a 14-year-old child on this issue as well. Finally, the former Davidian testified that he knew of no suicide pact or plan to set fire to the compound by Davidians. Sixth, we learned, contrary to Treasury prior account, that at least one ATF agent did carry a loaded gun on board a helicopter that went to the compound on raid day, despite testimony from the prosecutor of the Davidians that no one did so. Seventh, we read internal ATF documents that say pages of ATF surveillance notes on Koresh were, quote, torn out, unquote, of the ATF surveillance logs. We also read that documents associated with a rehired ATF agent previously fired due to his role in Waco were, quote, destroyed. Finally, as the joint investigating subcommittees moved on into the night, we heard from the widely respected former ATF deputy director who conceded under questioning that the Treasury report is, quote, filled with falsehoods and distortion of the facts and amounts to, and at first said cover, but changed the word cover up in later testimony. We will hear more from him today, and we will see more documents. The truth is being sought, and new facts are starting to come out. Today, we will start to finally get into the substance of what these hearings are designed to do, bring out the facts as to what happened at Waco, to assign accountability and responsibility. We owe the American people a full accounting of the truth, nothing less. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Zeloff. Ms. Thurman?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yesterday, we examined some of the events leading up to the decision to serve a search warrant at the Branch Davidian compound. We heard from two Branch Davidians who spoke about conditions at the compound prior to the raid. These hearings were convened to examine events before, during, and after the February 28, 1993 raid. Some of the testimony was painful to hear. However, it was necessary to shed light on conditions that local and federal law enforcement faced as they investigated charges. We will inevitably hear testimony today in subsequent days that will be painful and sometimes embarrassing. That is the point of holding these hearings, and in our search for the truth, we cannot shrink from looking at all the facts and points of views. And I look forward to hearing today's witnesses.
Thank you very much, Ms. Thurman. At this point, without objection, the questioning procedures, which all the members have before them and agreed to yesterday by the chairman and the ranking members of the two subcommittees and followed at yesterday's proceedings, will be utilized for today's hearings. Is there any objection?
Reserving the right to object.
Yes, Mr. Lantos.
I'd like to raise some issues and ask some questions, if I may.
Certainly.
Let me also say, by the way, that in my judgment, you have conducted your part of these hearings with great dignity and effectiveness, and I want to commend you.
Well, thank you.
Last night, at the conclusion of the hearing, a group of us from each side met privately to discuss the issues that several of us raised at the beginning of yesterday's proceedings. As Mr. Taylor so accurately points out, it's important to understand the events that led up to Waco. I believe it is equally appropriate and necessary in order to dispel the cloud that hangs over these hearings, to discuss the events that led up to the holding of these hearings, the people involved, the circumstances, the financing, the intricate intertwining of committee staff and staff of the National Rifle Association. At last night's private meeting, we requested the Republican leadership to return to us with an answer concerning the invitation to the relevant NRA officials to come here under oath and testify. And you and Mr. Zeloff indicated that you will need to consult with higher authorities and then give us your answer. I wonder if we may have that answer.
If the gentleman will yield,
I'll be happy to yield.
As I discussed last night with you, it is our opinion, and I have the utmost respect for the gentleman and understand the sincerity of his request. I want to make that statement as well. As you've been complimentary to me, I share that view of you. But as I said last night and we discussed in this meeting, the entrance of the question that you've posed in a formal fashion of subpoena in this committee during the hearings of this joint committee, during the hearings we're undertaking now, would go to procedural and questions of the conduct of committee staff and so forth, which are not to the substance of the Waco examination itself. And I would oppose that, or I do oppose any formal introduction of that into these hearings. However, as we discussed last night, we are willing and we are going to discuss the informal request aspect of this about the opportunity for discussions with perhaps NRA about this matter with our leadership. But we both said, I know I said it to Mr. Schumer as we were walking out last night, it would not be likely to be possible for that discussion to have been concluded by the beginning of today's hearings, and they've not been. I had a call into our leadership this morning. We didn't get out of that meeting, as you know, nearly midnight last night. I have not yet had an opportunity to have a discussion, and so consequently, I leave that matter, as I think you would have expected me to at this point, in an unresolved, yet-to-be-determined state.
Reclaiming my time, Mr. Chairman, there are a couple of observations I would like to make. I think it's very reasonable for you to point to the time constraints and your inability thus far to consult with your leadership. I would like to propose that we take a one-hour break at the conclusion of the morning session, which will give you an opportunity to consult with your leadership. This side does not wish to have this matter delayed ad infinitum. I fully disagree with you, with great respect, that we are dealing with a procedural issue. The intertwining of the National Rifle Association in the preparation of this hearing in a surreptitious manner goes very much to the heart of the substance that we are dealing with. That may not be your view, but it is the view of many of us on this side. None of us is entitled unilaterally to determine what is substance and what is procedure. In our judgment, this is very much substance. I also believe that, you know, some of the observations, even this morning, reveal, at least to me, a profound confusion of substance and procedure. Mr. Zalif, for instance, stated, and I'm quoting, Koresh, he just said it 5 minutes ago, Koresh is not a nice person. You said that verbatim. That is like saying that Hitler is not a lovable guy. I mean, you know, words have consequences. To say that someone is not a nice person does not begin to convey the monstrous character of this demon. We need to know what the NRA did for the preparation of this hearing.
Would the gentleman yield again?
I will be happy to yield, but I would like you, Mr. Chairman, to respond to my new and very polite specific request that at the conclusion of this morning's proceedings, a recess be taken to allow you and Mr. Zalif to consult with your leadership.
If the gentleman will yield, I would like to respond both to your point and to your question. First, to your point, I don't know, maybe the word substance versus procedure is not technically correct, but the subject matter of these hearings is to get at the question of what happened at Waco and the question of the issues you are raising with regard to NRA involvement or whatever go to issues that may be fundamentally a place that you could bring the proceedings in an ethics committee complaint or in a criminal complaint, or in some other forum. But I'm not personally convinced in any way that that has a place in the particular hearings we're having today. Now, the committee is willing to do what I indicated to you yesterday, and I will do that, and so will Mr. Zalif. We have been unable, we just discussed it very briefly with Mr. Klinger, Mr. Hyde this morning, but we haven't been able to even sit down with them more than 5 minutes. We will take a lunch break in due course today, as we did yesterday. I do not know if we will be able to conclude or have an opportunity to discuss these matters. We're chairing these hearings, we're proceeding with them today, and we're very consumed with them. But I would assume by sometime before the end of the day today, there will be contact made and we will have discussions and we can have a response for you either later today or certainly first thing in the morning.
Gentlemen, yield.
Reclaiming my time, I'm happy to yield.
Yeah, I thank the gentleman. I first want to underscore the gentleman from California's point. what happened in preparation of these hearings is intrinsically related to what these hearings are all about, how the issues are presented, are they done in a full and fair and impartial and unbiased way. So the two issues are related. Now, there are various ways to handle that. But to say that maybe 3 months from now we'll look at what happened after these hearings are over is closing the barn door after the horses are out of the barn, plain and simple. And so we urge the committee, the majority in the committee, to resolve this issue quickly with alacrity, because the issue of the fairness of the hearings and the issue of how the NRA influenced those hearings could be totally, could be none at all, is probably somewhere in between, is very, very, very important in terms of the fairness of the hearing, something that I know both the gentleman from Florida and the gentleman from New Hampshire have tried to consummate. And so I would say that, again, it would be my judgment that we would continue under the procedure we've agreed to, but please ask the majority to come to some conclusion one way or the other by the end of today.
Mr. Chairman. Rick
Jack. Yes, Mr. Conyers.
I'd like to associate myself with the remarks of the gentleman from California and New York. The problems with the suggestions that we've received from the Republicans in this committee is that we should go to the ethics committee to file a complaint, or perhaps we should go to the Department of Justice and file a criminal charge. The defect with those suggestions is that we don't know what the problem is that we would like to complain about. We're searching for facts right now. We're trying to determine what the relationship of NRA people were during the investigation process. And so I don't have an ethics complaint now. And by you telling us to do everything but cooperating with getting the people before us to determine the depth of the problem, the nature of the problem, is really quite evasive. The reason being that these hearings are proceeding under a cloud around this question. And so I'm hopeful that this be determined tomorrow. I'm going to ask, based on the thoughtful presentation of Tom Lantos, that we do not object to the proceedings today, and that we let our agreement go forward with the understanding that this is the last day that we are going to tolerate any stalling on the questions of how NRA may have impacted upon the investigation leading to these hearings.
Would the gentleman yield?
Would
the gentleman yield
Mr.
just
McCullough.
For the moment?
Of course.
And then I certainly will recognize Mr. Hyde. First of all, I do not believe that you can expect necessarily to have a favorable resolution to your perspective on this, even should we go through the leadership as we have said we would, just to have a discussion. Because as I've said earlier, it seems to me you're pressing for a matter that I personally would not deem to be appropriate to these hearings. So let me at least broach the subject this way so that everybody understands this as we discussed last night. Should we not reach concurrence on this, and should you or Mr. Lantos or Mr. Schumer or anyone else wish to object to the unanimous consent request that we have been conducting either today or tomorrow about the process, we will revert to the 5-minute rule. And we will simply go through a longer process, but we will go forward with the hearings. I just want everybody to understand that that will be the net sum gain of this. The hearings will go forward. I'm going to yield at this point of the reservation request to Mr. Hyde.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Reserving the right to object, I think one of the most telling remarks I've heard this decade was just uttered by my good friend Mr. Conyers. They got to find out what the problem is. They are a bunch of legislators in search of a problem. Anything but let's proceed with hearings on Waco. Now, the fact is the NRA had no official, unofficial, any relationship with any of the Republicans on any of the subcommittees conducting these hearings. And if you wish to question the conduct of a private party who volunteered their services, quote, quote, then go question that party. But I don't intend to recommend a subpoena because that's a diversion from what we are inquiring about. Waco, 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 not NRA. I don't, not at this time. I don't propose to inquire who your staff has consulted with on this or any other matter of concern in a moment. Whoever you talk to is your business, but to go off on an excursion as to what some third person, an outsider, may or may not have done and what its possible impact is at this time is simply an effort to obfuscate and to divert the attention of this committee to the facts surrounding Waco. Now, if the gentleman can cite any unfairness, if the gentleman can cite the fact that they have not been permitted to ask questions fully, they haven't been permitted to come forward with witnesses, every indicia of fairness is here. And we have bent over backwards to make sure the hearings are fair and complete. We are not taking sides here. We aren't here to protect the ATF, to protect David Koresh. We are here to find out what happened, to learn what happened, what caused it, and how we can make sure something like this, which is a tragedy, could never happen again.
And the right to object,
would the gentleman yield to me, please? He's referred to me.
Oh, indeed I have. And if Mr. Schumer wants me to refer to him, to elevate him to the...
I just want you to yield to me, but if you'd like to refer to me, that's your
problem. Mr. Schumer, I like saying that. Mr. Lantos, too. Yes, go ahead. Well, I yield to the...
It has a ring to it.
Yeah, it has a certain resonance.
To refer to one to get into this conversation, I would like for him maybe to refer to me,
absolutely. Mr. Watt.
Would you yield to me,
Mr. Watt. Mr. Watt, and Ms. Jackson-Lee, too, while we're at it.
I'd like to reserve the point.
Well, on the first of all, on his reservation, does Mr. Hyde yield to anybody, or are you?
I yield to Mr. Conyers.
Well, I thank the gentleman for yielding. The fact of the matter is that I put this in the gentlest way possible now as subject to the most extreme description that I've ever heard. The reason that we need to talk to these people is that we need to have the subpoena power, which only the majority can give us. Now, you were not at the meeting last night when we went through this in detail, and I thought we were making some progress. And we are not looking at your staff, sir, and that was another thing that we agreed in the subpoena process. We're looking at the people who may have tainted the investigation. To where it will lead, I don't know. But I'm saying this not trying to stall Waco. The hearings can proceed if you will only allow us to have the authority to call the witnesses.
Reclaiming my time just for a second, how in the world have these hearings been tainted? Would the gentleman tell me what... How was taint injected into this? I'm yielding to Mr. Conyers.
The reason that we don't know whether they've been tainted is we haven't been able to call the parties forward.
So speculation on top of a hypothesis.
There's no speculation. There's no hypothesis. We want to talk to the people.
Well, nothing. No one is stopping you from talking to them. In a moment,
we can't talk to them, Chairman, as you well know, unless we are they're prepared to come in if we require them to. They're not going to voluntarily.
Continuing
come
my
in.
Reservation, I yield to Mr. Buyer of Indiana.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One thing I have learned in growing up on the Tippecanoe River back in Indiana, and that is where the river is the deepest, it runs the most silent, and where the river is the shallowest, it makes the most noise.
That's one thing I learned about growing up on the Tippecanoe River. And that's what we have here, is a very shallow argument.
Is the gentleman
and they're making a lot of noise.
Is the gentleman saying that some of our objectors are all wet? Is that what the gentleman...
No.
Is that what the gentleman
is saying? No, not at all. But that's what we have here. Mr. Chairman, I think your points are very well taken, that we have a tremendous diversion tactic being done here. Hopefully we can get on with the Waco hearings. There are a lot of good points that need to be made. I've worked several months, and so have my staff, on the issues about the military involvement. At no time have we ever been contacted in any way with regard to the NRA. So this is a tremendous red herring, and I think the American people are recognizing that. And if my colleagues want to continue with that, I think the American people will judge you that you want to participate in dilatory tactics, obstructionism, for us to get into what are the problems here. We want to make sure that we restore the faith and confidence of the American people in our law enforcement activities, and that's what we seek to do. But if you want to obstruct that form of seeking justice, go right ahead, and I think the American people will not be kind in their judgment on you, and I yield back to the chairman.
Continuing with my reservation, I yield to Mr. Klinger, the chairman of the Reform and Oversight
Committee. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for yielding to me. And I think that the only issue I'd like to raise here is, you say you cannot speak with or discuss any of these matters with the people of that may or may not have had some involvement from the NRA. Has anybody actually tried to speak to them? My understanding is that the NRA has volunteered, has offered to come up and discuss these matters. As you're asking this committee to involve itself in something that we had nothing to do with. We were not in any way involved with what the NRA was about. I think if there are questions that you want to address the NRA, call them up and ask them if they would come up and discuss it. I think they have indicated they would be willing to do that.
Continuing with my reservation, I yield to Mr. Micah, Florida.
Mr. Hyde and Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, I'm a little bit concerned about what's proceeding here, and I want to tell you too, from our side of the aisle, that if the other side continues with these requests for subpoena, that some of us on this side would like to see, and our side grants this request, we would like to also see an expansion of people brought before this panel. There are reports in the media that, in fact, the White House has brought in, I don't know his name, the correct pronunciation, Rahm Emanuel, one of the more aggressive members of a political team, put in charge of coordinating the White House public response, joining a team of Treasury Department aides. And I want to know if they're attempting to influence what we heard here yesterday in a potential cover-up of what's going on and the blame here. So if we're going to expand this, I would demand from this side that we bring them in. We bring in Mr. John Podesta, who also, I think, is in the private sector now, who has been brought in, and that when this committee and this majority cannot get access to the weapons that were in Waco, and then the minority brings them in, I want to know what's going on here and how you are subverting and perverting the system and this process. All we want is the facts of what took place there. I want to know if those guns, in fact, were altered. I want to know, in fact, if this man did have illegal weapons. And I think the American people deserve that right to know. So if we're going to expand the scope of this, then I'm going to sit here and reserve the right to object, and I'm going to demand that we get to the bottom of this and as to how your side is operating in this setting.
Well, I now yield to the gentleman under my reservation of right. The gentleman from Brooklyn, Mr. Schumer.
Thank you. Brooklyn and Queens now, Mr. Chairman. Moving out, I don't know about moving up. I just make two points. First, to explain to my colleagues on the other side, you see us as sort of the gentleman from Illinois, whose integrity is unquestioned, I think, by anybody on this side, is talking about, well, we're going to get into committee documents, we're going to get into what the staff did and who they've talked to. To us, that seems rather funny and anomalous, because your side is making that very same argument with the White House, first with the President's documents, now with Webb Hubble's documents, the very same argument. And this is not a tit-for-tat issue. I have complete feeling that you're looking at those sincerely. You want to overturn every stone, even as far-fetched as it seems to us. Well, we don't think our argument is far-fetched. You think it is. You don't think your argument is far-fetched. We think it is, but the two are quite analogous. And so what I would say is this. It seems to me, first of all, that let's treat each argument with equal weight. We're not doing that right now. Oh, yes, there's a cover-up of Webb Hubble or something because one phone log is missing. Or the White House didn't reveal President Clinton's personal scribbles, which they then did. That is important. That is essential. And I hear words come from the other side of cover-up. And yet, when we want documents that it's been documented in the media, when we want interview witnesses who relate to the hearing process, and it involves going into the same type of documents, oh, that's absurd, that's far afield, etc. To resolve this in a way, I do want to continue with the hearings, as I have all along. I think yesterday was very, very helpful in terms of setting the perspective and setting the tone for the American people.
Would the gentleman say yesterday's hearings were fair?
I would say that in general, we were given certain opportunities. Yes, there were other witnesses we wanted to call who couldn't come. But given the fact of majority, what does fair mean? Were they 50-50? No. But did you give the minority some rights to be heard and have some of our witnesses by all means?
The gentleman is a master of circumlocution.
Thank you. I will travel around the globe.
I yield back, and I thank the gentleman.
I thank the gentleman. Can I just finish my point?
Mr. Chairman?
Reserving the right to object, I hear. Do you reserve the right to object, Mr. Schumer?
I thought he had yielded back to me.
He yielded back to the chair.
Oh, okay.
Do you reserve the right to object?
Well, then this river will stop flowing for the moment.
Mr. Watt, you reserve the right to object?
I reserve the right to object.
Mr. Watt, you're recognized.
I thank
you. Very subtle and clever, Mr. Boyer.
The right to Mr. Watt has been recognized.
I thank the chairman for recognizing me, and I hate to disappoint Mr. Bouyou, but since I didn't learn to swim until late, I've been swimming in shallow water for a long time, and I continue to do so. Most of what we're swimming in here is shallow, in fact, in my opinion. I am delighted, first of all, that the chairman's resolution of this issue, if we in fact get to the point of objecting to the proceeding, is to go back to regular order. And so I just wanted to let you know that even if you all resolved this issue, it seems to me that you still may have an objection if it will get us back to regular order. This whole notion that you were going to save time by coming up with a new procedure which deprived members on both sides of the opportunity to question witnesses and do what we customarily do and do what we elected to do, I think has now been shown to be a simple farce. So everybody is now taking their reservation of right to do what they had the right to do in the first place if you had not put this procedure into effect. And it's just another example of how the procedures in this House that have worked so many years have a sense of rationality to them and a sense of fairness to them, and equalizes the opportunity of members to participate because we are, in fact, equal. What's happened here is that several people on this committee have used this hearing as a political stage. The leadership is using it as a political stage and doesn't want anybody else to play in this. And this should not be about politics. If we're going to have a hearing in this committee, it ought to be about finding what the facts are and moving towards some kind of legislative rather than some kind of political conclusion.
Would the gentleman
The gentleman yield to the chairman.
I'd be happy to yield that as soon as I finish making my point, and then I'm through with this again for today. I'll be back again tomorrow when you all try to let me participate again. And maybe I can reserve the right to object again tomorrow and get involved in the process. But basically what you all have done is come up with a set of rules that have generated an hour and a half of delay at the beginning of every day, which we could have used for some constructive purpose rather than the destructive purpose that has turned out to be used for. And I'd be happy to yield to the
thank
gentleman.
You. I thank the gentleman, and I wholeheartedly agree with his comments to let's get on to the real issues of the
well,
day.
Well, I thank you for agreeing with me. I'll claim back my time now since you've agreed with me. I'll go right ahead. I'll yield to you.
I think that we have some very important points to cover, and I think that tactics to just divert the real issue of the day, I think are quite lamentable. And I say this as a person, as well as with Mr. Blute's comments yesterday, who voted for the Brady Bill, who voted in favor of the ban on semi-assault weapons, who gets no support for the NRA. If they rate legislators, I'm sure that I have as low a rating as Mr. Schumer and many others. But I believe that the purpose of this hearing is a very important one, and I think today's topics are very important. We're going to talk about
the poor
training. Well, I
wonder if the gentlelady, reclaiming my time, I wonder if she would join with me in insisting that the leadership provide the opportunity for everybody on this committee the opportunity to participate in it. I hope you'll vote in favor of that when
further yield.
If the time ever comes that we get to that. And I really don't want to prolong the hearing. I think we are wasting taxpayer money here.
Regular order has been.
If the gentleman will yield, I'm concerned that taxpayers' money is being abused in this raid as well. And I think that if we would have the opportunity.
I'm sorry, I've got to interrupt the gentlelady and the gentleman. Regular order has been called by Mr. Klinger under the rules of the House and the rules of the committee. When regular order is called in these circumstances where somebody's discussing a reservation of the right to object, at that point in time, an objection has to either be given or not. There is no further debate. Is there an objection to the proceedings today?
I object.
Then we're going to proceed now under the five-minute rule. And I think we should all know that we're going to have about 2.5 hours for each round of questions, and we'll have four panels today. We probably will not complete all four today and may shift one to tomorrow. But we are going to proceed right now with the first panel. And I call the first panel of witnesses if we can have them come forward. First is Robert Sanders. Robert Sanders was formerly the Deputy Director for Enforcement of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. If Mr. Sanders could come forward and take his seat on the left side, and each of the witnesses I call, I believe your nameplates will be, and in fact I see them from my left to right, your right to left. The second witness is Wade Ishimoto. Wade Ishimoto is technical manager at Sandia National Laboratories in Albuquerque, New Mexico. He's also a former military officer with extensive tactical training. George Morrison is our third witness. George Morrison is the former chief of the Los Angeles Police Department, Metro Tactical Department. Our fourth witness is John Kuntz. John Kuntz is an expert in tactics related to drug enforcement operations for the Drug Enforcement Administration. And our last witness on this panel is Donald A. Bassett. Donald Bassett was an FBI special agent for over 30 years and headed the FBI's crisis management team during that period of time. I can pull my swearing document out here, an oath document. If each of you would rise, I'd like to ask you to raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Please be seated. Let the record reflect that each of the witnesses answered that in the affirmative. We're now ready to proceed with the questioning in the five-minute order.
You recognize Schiff for 5 minutes.
Wait a second.
I yield. I'm the first one to be recognized under this process, and I am going to yield my 5 minutes to Mr. Schiff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for yielding. Mr. Chairman, I'm going to take 1 minute to just tell the panel what my point of view and point of reference in these questions is. My questions are going to emphasize the role of law enforcement agencies. I would point out that the headlines in a Washington Daily paper this morning read, "Teenager tells Waco panel of Koresh's lust." This is a Washington Daily paper. I can't imagine how the tabloids are possibly going to top that particular headline. Now, regardless of whether one uses the euphemism that David Koresh was not a nice guy, or the suggestion that he was a monster, or anywhere in between, David Koresh did not work for the federal government in 1993. And I think that we can assume that, federal law enforcement agents have to regularly deal with individuals who are not nice guys or who are in fact monsters. But we still at all times expect them to act professionally. And one of the main purposes of this hearing is to determine if that did happen or did not happen. And one quick final word. I just want to say that if there are shortcomings in law enforcement shown in this hearing, I wouldn't want it to be a broad brush that paints every federal law enforcement agent around the country. Hundreds of agents day in and day out do their work in a dedicated and professional manner, regardless of mistakes that might be made by some others. With that, gentlemen, I want to concentrate on the issue of the use of the military with local law enforcement. And to speed matters along here, I want to say that it is my understanding, and would ask if any of you would correct me, that normally speaking, the military does not interact on a regular or daily basis with civilian law enforcement, whether it's local or whether it's federal, on day-to-day law enforcement. Does anyone disagree with that conclusion? All right. Seeing no disagreement, can I move on for a moment? It's my further understanding that because of the limitations in the Posse Comitatus Act, which limit federal military authority to work with civilian law enforcement, and for financial constraint reasons, even if the Posse Comitatus Act does not come into relevancy, that when the military does act with local law enforcement, there's usually a special reason why they do so, a special circumstance, special kind of crime. Would anyone disagree with that? All right. Okay. Mr. Ishimoto, and by the way, Mr. Ishimoto, being from Sandia National Laboratories in Albuquerque, New Mexico, may I give you a special welcome here today? Please.
Thank you, Mr. Schiff. And may I emphasize that I am not here as an official representative of Sandia National Laboratories, but as a private citizen that was asked to assist in the Treasury review. My disagreement, sir, is with respect to the fact that the military frequently gets involved in terms of training law enforcement officials in many different circumstances away from specific law enforcement operations.
Okay. Does it normally train for raids, Mr. Ishimoto?
Raid training has occurred in many, many instances, especially with the formation of the Joint Task Force 6 operation in particular, but with long-standing things that were occurring before.
Well, let me try to move on, just because you've heard we've changed the procedures here. Isn't a drug connection the most frequent or a frequent reason why the military is used to assist civilian law enforcement? Would you agree with that, Mr. Ishimoto?
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, let me ask, Mr. Sanders, you are now a retired from the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Department. Is that right?
Yes, sir, Mr. Schiff.
Pardon?
Yes, that's correct.
Does the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Department normally investigate whether somebody is operating a methamphetamine creation laboratory?
Not normally. Occasionally, the ATF jurisdiction does touch upon drugs because of the nature of the offender, not the nature of the offense. In other words, if the offender is violating the federal firearms laws, then he would come within the purview of ATF jurisdiction.
But if a central issue of law enforcement is, in fact, a drug operation, under federal organization, wouldn't that more be the jurisdiction of the Department of the Drug Enforcement Agency?
Yes, sir, that's right.
Mr. Kuntz, you're with the Drug Enforcement Agency. Do you agree with that statement, that normally the Drug Enforcement Agency handles drug enforcement issues?
Yes, sir, I do.
Mr. Schiff? Mr. Chairman, I just want to hold my time as my time is shown as expired, Mr. Chairman, and I don't want to create a precedent here.
Mr. Chairman, is this time expired?
Your time has expired at this point. Thank you, Mr. Schiff. Mr. Schumer? You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And first, I would just make one point in reference to Mr. Schiff's point, and that is the issue of Mr. Koresh, who he was, what he was first brought up by the witness, Mr. Morrison, was it? The professor from Texas, who, that was his whole testimony. He was chosen by the majority, so obviously people think it is relevant to this hearing, despite the protests after you heard what you didn't like. But Mr. Morrison's whole testimony was about the mindset of, and the people who wrote in his books, of Mr. Court. Was it Morrison? First witness, the second witness yesterday.
Stuart Wright.
Mr. Wright, excuse me. So obviously both sides think that that is relevant. What I'd like to do is ask a few questions in my 5 minutes to Mr. Sanders. My first question, Mr. Sanders, is, I need the first sheet, I don't need that sheet. All right, my first question to you is, you have been counsel and represented a number of clients as defendants in criminal cases brought by the ATF and plaintiffs in civil litigation against ATF, do you not?
That's correct, sir. Not plaintiffs in any tort suits. I don't do any tort suits.
Right. But you've done them in Bivens-type lawsuits, correct?
Yes, administrative matters and licensing matters, importing matters.
Right.
Relating to firearms.
Okay. And there are a good number of suits where you have been the lawyer opposing the ATF, is that right?
That's correct, sir.
Okay. My next question to you is, in fact, your law practice is pretty much one of attacking the ATF, isn't that right?
No, I wouldn't.
We're representing
say
people against the ATF. Let's not characterize it. That's the basis of your...
I would characterize it as representing private clients who are accused or are interested in obtaining something from the executive branch of the government.
Right. Okay. Does the NRA or any of its affiliates refer those cases to you on occasion?
I receive referrals from all quarters, from word of mouth, from special interest groups.
Do you get some? I understand you will take them, good case from wherever, but does the NRA refer cases to
you?
Yes,
they do, sir.
Significant number?
I wouldn't say significant number, maybe on the average of 3-4 a year.
Okay. Let me ask you a few more questions here, because just to tell my colleagues that you were the panelist who was identified as former ATF enforcement person, although it is true. What year did you leave the ATF?
1984,
so long before Waco was a glimmer in anybody's eye. You know nothing about the Waco issue itself.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I have no personal knowledge of the facts.
Okay. Do you know Tanya Matoska?
I have met Ms. Matoska. I don't know her.
Have you been with her in the last, met with her, or been together with her in the last 4 or 5 months?
I have, yes, sir.
Okay.
I have been not with her, but in a setting where she had been present.
Yes, well, that's what I mean, in the same room. Can you tell us when and where?
I was present with her on probably 3 occasions.
Right.
One was at the NRA building in Virginia. One was at the NRA office in Washington. And one was in the office of congressman.
Mm-hmm. Which congressman was that?
It was the chairman of the Appropriations Committee.
And what was the purpose of that meeting?
I met with Mr. Lightfoot because it was my understanding that he was interested in hearing some views about ATF.
Uh-huh. And were you ever introduced by her as on retainer by the NRA?
I was not, sir, and
you're
I am
sure?
Not. Pardon?
You sure of that? You're under
yes,
oath?
Sir.
Okay. Next question. Have you had this relationship with the NRA for quite a while in terms of referring cases, meeting with them, etc.?
Yes, sir, I have.
Do you know Warren Cassidy? He's the former NRA Executive Director for Legislative Action.
Yes, sir. He was in that position when I was assistant director of ATF.
Pardon? I didn't hear that.
He was in that position when I was the assistant director of ATF.
But did you know him after you left ATF?
I don't believe I ever met him after I left ATF.
I see. What was your relationship with him when you were at ATF?
I met him. That was the extent of it.
Mr. Schumer, your time is up. Mr. Zeliff, for 5 minutes.
I yield to Mr. Schiff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to say first that it could be assumed, and it turned out to be entirely correct, that testimony of child abuse by a young girl would get a headlines in the newspaper over the fact that the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Department couldn't put the right United States Code statute number on the arrest warrant in the David Koresh case. Although that could be assumed to be the headline, I think the relevance to this hearing about the fact that a government agent doesn't know the United States Code under which he's proposing to arrest people is far more significant. And I think that the idea that any mistakes in the raid were occurred as a result of the haste to liberate children from this compound when the arrest warrant and search warrant never mentioned a child abuse violation, only a firearms violation, is in my mind a last-minute invention to cover certain backsides in government. Now, I want to ask the panel, going back to the military, if civilian law enforcement went to the military, federal or National Guard, and said that they needed help because of a drug connection in a criminal case, would that lend help in getting that aid from the military? Would anyone care to respond on that? I believe the answer is yes, but would ask you, Mr. Koontz, you're with DEA. Would I be correct about that?
Yes, sir. I personally have never used the military, sir.
All right. I don't know if your microphone's on, sir.
I personally have never used the military.
But you do know the military is active in anti-drug efforts?
Yes, sir, I do.
And you do know that civilian law enforcement has gone to the military and asked for assistance in anti-drug efforts?
Yes, sir, I do.
All right. Now, if civilian law enforcement goes to the military and represents that a case they are working on has a significant drug connection, would you expect that information to be true?
Yes, sir, I would. All
right. And would it be a serious matter if it wasn't true?
I would personally think it would be a serious matter.
Okay. Let me ask, in the cases that you know of, where the where civilian law enforcement has asked the military for assistance in drug cases, has the following arrest warrant or search warrant normally then been for violation of drug laws?
My only familiarity with the military in conjunction with civilian, in particular the Drug Enforcement Administration, has been in the marijuana eradication program in Oklahoma. And certainly it has resulted in indictments and trials.
For what charge?
For violation of federal narcotic laws.
Not
cultivation. Cultivation of marijuana.
So from the experience you have had, when civilian law enforcement went to the military to ask for assistance in fighting a violation of the drug laws, the result was an indictment for violation of drug crimes?
In the majority of instances, but that's not to say that you couldn't have any other violations of federal law or state law.
In addition to the drug laws?
That's correct, sir.
Do you know of any other case where the military was asked for assistance in fighting a violation of drug laws that the resulting case wasn't related to the drug laws, at least in part?
Sir, I don't know. All I can relate to you is my experiences in Oklahoma.
I understand. I'm going to turn for the balance of this time, and I don't know how far I'll get in the time, but I'm going to turn now generally to the raid at Waco. You've all been put together as an outside panel of experts who've worked in law enforcement but who were not participants in this particular incident. And I would like to ask your an overview quick. Was it well planned? Was it not well planned? And what would you have done differently? And I will begin with you, Mr. Ishimoto, if I may, from my hometown. And if we run out of time, when I get my own 5 minutes, we'll come back.
Thank you, Mr. Schiff. I want to emphasize that there were six tactical experts brought in as consultants for the Treasury Review in 1993, and we were allowed access to any bit of information that we so requested. In doing so, and one of my colleagues was George Morrison to my left, as we did our interviews, then it was very obvious to us that the raid, in fact, did fail. So in hindsight, it would have been the easiest thing to have said the plan was absolutely badly done. However, in fairness, then, I turned back to some former training that I had and to look at some 9 very proven principles of different kinds of operations, in particular those that require the use of force. And I thought that the ATF plan had a reasonable chance of success based on those 9 principles. In fact, of those 9 principles, there was only one, which I'll call economy of force, which really means that you have reserves.
I'm out of time, so I have to ask for a very brief response here. Okay. I'm sorry. I'll try to get back to you. What would you have done differently? 1 or 2 things you would have done differently, if anything?
What I would have done differently would have been to look at critical success factors and to gauge my forward observers and intelligence personnel to report on that prior to proceeding.
Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much. Ms. Thurman?
Just for the record, it's my understanding that there are 2 that appear at the witness were the only ones that actually have either reviewed it or somehow been involved in that. Is that correct? And has Mr. Bassett, Mr. Kuntz, I believe Mr. Morrison and Mr. Shimoto were actually part of the review team, and Mr. Saunders, could you tell me?
Yes, that's correct.
So,
I was not part of the review team. Okay. For Treasury, no.
Okay, so Mr. Ishimoto and Mr. Morrison were the 2 actually that have reviewed the information. Mr. Ishimoto, Mr. Morrison, maybe together. Give me an idea of the kinds of steps you took in doing the review. Was it thorough? Did you have access to what you believed was all the information? Did you get to take testimony? Did you get to review information that has been brought up here in the last 2 days of things that maybe other people feel like they didn't get a chance to see? And do you feel like you completed a thorough report here?
I'd comment that our information was developed over a period of several months and is contained in the Treasury Department's
right.
report. And I think in the interest of your time here that information pretty well explains and would cover quite more than 5 minutes of testimony. At no time did I find any resistance to providing information. Some information was not available either because there was not a document form for it, or it was part of the ongoing internal investigation as to conflicting statements by witnesses, Treasury Department employees. I referenced that information in my report that's contained in the overall text. But I found that the investigative process was open, was responsive. One of the first issues that was raised was an examination of the actual warrant application itself to determine if the plan was developed off the information contained in the warrant and if the information in the warrant was consistent with case management and intelligence that had been acquired during the initial process prior
to the And from that record, did you find that to be true?
No, I found that there were flaws in the case management process and in the intelligence management process.
Mr. Shimoto, would you like to comment?
Are there some specifics, Mrs. Thurman, that I can comment on? Or I addressed Mr. Schiff's comments by saying that we had total access to any bit of information that we requested, and the Treasury officials that were conducting the review were very cooperative along those lines.
Did you find any conspiracy or malicious
I found no conspiracy in my review. I found perhaps some inexperience on some people's parts, but no criminal negligence.
In the review, you, I believe, gave some recommendations to ways we might have done better. Is that correct?
Yes, and that was what we were specifically asked to look at, to recommend
lessons learned in the aftermath of this failure to preclude that from happening.
And I believe that in many of our opening statements by all members here in the last yesterday, that that was one of the things that we're trying to get at is, how can we ever prevent this from happening again? Maybe you could, both of you, maybe expand on some of the things that you saw that you believe we might, maybe as Congress should take, or maybe as the departments or agencies should take, that we would give us an idea of what you believe we could be doing here.
But once again, I would refer to the content of the report. We had a chance to take quite a bit of time to develop that, but I think primarily it's a matter of expansion of roles. I believe that from my practical experience in the Los Angeles area, working closely with ATF, in my review of the Waco incident, that the role of the ATF has expanded rapidly in the last several years. The complexity of their operations has expanded, and in many cases, the management review and control has not expanded accordingly. I think that falls toward training, toward internal management audit, toward reorganization to the extent of having inspection and control processes. And each of the six experts, quote experts, took different areas. I took the one of the management approach and the command and control aspect.
Thank you.
Ms. Thurman, your time has expired. Mr. Hyde, you just come in. Do you wish the time, or do you wish to have me pass over you at this
point?
You
can pass over me.
Mr. Schiff, Mr.
I understand that if I take my time, I can yield to Mr. Schiff.
Yes, you may.
Well, I'm happy to do so.
All right, very well. Mr. Schiff, you're recognized on Mr. Hyde's time for 5 minutes.
I want to say to the panel, you've heard our change in procedures, and each speaker has only 5 minutes. So with that in mind, I'm going to ask four of you the question I asked Mr. Ishimoto and ask for a brief response. Beginning with Mr. Sanders, I'd like to ask this question. Would you have done anything different in the planning of this raid that the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms did at Waco if you were doing it, and if any changes? Mr. Sanders, would you answer that question, please?
Yes. If my purpose was to execute an arrest warrant and a search warrant, I wouldn't have done it in that way.
What would you have done differently?
I really don't know, but I would not have mounted an assault involving military-equipped people to attack, absolutely assault, a compound containing more than 100 men, women, and children.
Mr. Morrison.
I would have had a more active management review process of the information that was developed leading to the decision to conduct a high-risk search warrant entry.
Mr. Kuntz.
Mr. Schiff, my field of expertise is in the clandestine manufacture of controlled substance and not in raid planning, so I don't think I could honestly respond to your question.
Well, let me follow up on that, Mr. Kuntz. Are you aware that it has been suggested that the military was told that surveillance and other kind of training assistance was needed because of a necessity to locate a drug methamphetamine lab in this situation?
Only through the media, sir.
To the best of your knowledge and your agency's knowledge, did the Department of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms ever contact DEA and say, we need some assistance, we're dealing with a drug lab here?
Sir, I don't know the answer to that question.
Right. I wonder if you could try to find that out and give that answer in some form to the chairman of the committee as to whether ATF contacted DEA and said, you're the drug experts, we have a drug lab problem, what should we do? I wonder if you'd follow up as best you could.
I certainly will do that, sir.
I thank you, Mr. Kuntz. Mr. Bassett, please, same question.
Mr. Schiff, the question is difficult to answer with a simple answer because I problems with the raid as being multidimensional. And I would like to qualify my comments on the raid specifically by noting that my knowledge of the raid is based upon my reading of relevant sections of the report which my colleagues contributed to under the Treasury Department review. If I were to pinpoint a major area of concern, it would be intelligence and the rigor with which the intelligence was gathered and appreciated by the raid planners.
Could you expand on that for a minute? What do you mean concern about the intelligence? What did you see as you reviewed it?
Well, my concern was that the raid was based largely on expectations of surprise, which in turn was based on intelligence that, in hindsight, was not adequate. And over-reliance was perhaps placed on intelligence which did not have a firm basis in fact.
Mr. Sanders, let me go back to you, if I may. You said that you would not have put together a military-type operation in the first place. Was it your understanding that this was a military-type of operation?
I only know what I saw and what I've read in the public domain, and it was an assault.
And why would you not have done it that way?
Well, the special agents of ATF execute search warrants and arrest warrants every day. And I would have gone to them and told them to figure out a way to execute this arrest warrant and execute this search warrant.
Mr. Morrison, you said that you would have looked for more active management review. Would you be kind enough to explain what you mean about that?
Yes, again, this is contained in my report, but the areas of the intelligence case management and in the investigative case management causing closure of points that were raised at various stages of the investigation, causing closure of intelligence information that was offered but not analyzed and given credibility. I think that those areas were very critical in the decision to go ahead with the tactical raid. I think that the tactical planners, to make it very brief, the tactical planners were denied critical information or at least appropriate verification of information in the process of preparing a raid. I believe that that information was inadvertently denied them. It wasn't a deliberate cover-up.
Okay, my time has expired. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Mr. Schiff. Mr. Scott, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to follow up a little bit on the comments of the gentlelady from Florida, because I think we ought to focus on what we can do to avoid this outcome in the future. Yesterday, in response to several questions I asked, one of the witnesses indicated that if police misconduct is an allegation, the sole tool we have to deal with that is the exclusionary rule. There's virtually no other sanction that's been useful in dealing with police misconduct. In this case, we have a situation where we have a person that is, I think, could reasonably be predicted or evaluated to be unpredictable. And the question is how you execute a search warrant in a situation like that without risking the lives of those who are trying to serve the warrant and without risking the lives of innocent bystanders. And we showed in this situation, from start to finish, we showed two ways how not to do it. What factors would you consider if you had a similar situation? Is there any way to execute the warrant, knowing what you know now, on a similar person who is fully armed, and we're having other groups that are developing these the amount of armament? Is there any way you can execute an arrest warrant and a search warrant without risking the lives of officers and innocent bystanders, knowing what you know now? Mr. Ishimoto?
Mr. Scott, I find that to be very problematic because of the fact that what we know today was not necessarily known as fact during the raid planning and actual execution. It is simple to say that perhaps attempts could have been made to arrest Vernon Wayne Howell or David Koresh off of the compound. But the intelligence, as Mr. Bassett referred to, was not sufficient at that time, and certainly we can be critical of ATF in terms of their intelligence effort.
Enough. It had not been coordinated because apparently somebody on our side had the information, but it had not been shared with the other agencies. Is that true?
No, sir. It was, in my review, it was very evident that they did not have the information that
No agency of the federal government had the information?
That Koresh was leaving the site on a frequent basis?
Right.
Not to the best of my knowledge and during our review.
what other types of entry, with the various forms of entry, are there some that have a lower risk of loss of life than others?
The dynamic entry has been proven time and time again in law enforcement use in this country and internationally to have a lesser lethality in terms of loss of life, both on the part of the suspect as well as on law enforcement officials serving that warrant.
And what are the essential elements of the dynamic entry which reduce the likelihood of lethality?
Amongst those are surprise and speed and proper massing of the number of forces to overwhelm the people and to basically intimidate them so they do not resist.
Was there any way to bring these three factors into play in this situation?
Yes, and I believe ATF attempted to do that. They lost the element of surprise, perhaps without their full knowledge.
And is there any way halfway, when you have this, ought you not have an alternative plan when you find halfway through that things aren't going right, that you can retreat before you get into trouble?
They had those plans. Frankly, they could have been better developed. But I believe that the reason for them not being able to develop those plans better was their inexperience.
Now, and so it's your testimony that knowing what we know now, we would perform better in a similar situation?
Yes, and I am aware that ATF has attempted to change their crisis management training and their special response team training.
This time I yield to Mr. Schiff, 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield my 5 minutes to Ms. Ross-Leitner.
Thank you, Mr. Schiff. Mr. Morrison, reading your analysis of the raid, and I'm going to quote from your report, the absence of management review led to a serious breach of integrity, falsification of documents. And you go on to say in the next page, once again, this component of planning points to ineffective management and command and control. The absence of accountability charting throughout the BATF resulted in errors, omissions, and failures in the investigation, intelligence, approval, planning, and incident management of the Waco incident. Do you stand by your report, Mr. Morrison?
Yes, that is my opinion and my belief.
Excuse me?
That was my opinion and belief based on the information I had available.
That was your opinion, and do you still believe that today?
Yes.
Part of the criticism of the plan, in addition to what was discussed, was its lack of abort conditions. Who was ultimately responsible for this shortcoming, and what does it say about the planning of this operation?
I believe the...
Could you hold your microphone a little closer?
I believe that the abort procedure was in there but was not followed. There were a number of what I termed, I believe in my report, as red flag indications that would have prompted the person in charge to have aborted that mission. One was losing the element of surprise. I think that was a critical issue. I don't believe that there was a full flow of information to the tactical team leaders who were committed to the raid as to the conditions that were developing during the last hour prior to the raid. In that area, the abort procedure had to have a very clear chain of command. Who was in charge? At what point was information provided? And who was going to make that decision?
And what does it say became, then about the planning of this operation if that was
if
not
If I may continue
clear.
On that one point, I think what caused that problem and that confusion was the lack of experience in this type of a very large-scale raid and the absence of a clear-cut chain of command and tactical procedure for command.
And related to this chain of command is the unity of command. Is that not one of the guiding principles of these operations? Why do you think it's important in this sort of operation to have one person in charge?
Well, I believe I stated that in my report. I believe it's clear that someone has to be the one taking the responsible role, and that person has to have access to all information. from the actual tactical team leaders making the entry, the forward observation posts, any other type of observation or intelligence gathering that's going on at the time, that all has to be part of the planning, the game plan, and clearly communicated to all participants in the raid. Who makes what decision? The raid could have been called off by one of the tactical team leaders under certain conditions. There are various places where that, those gates can come up to abort based on information present. That has to be clearly developed within the plan as at what point does what supervisor, team leader, tactical commander, whatever terminology is used, have a responsibility to make an observation and to either commit to a green light going ahead or aborting a mission.
And in this incident, who had the power to abort the attack when surprise was lost?
I believe that that was somewhat confused. I think the power existed within about three levels. I don't think that the communication system was there, nor the organizational management system there to clearly determine that. That was one of the things we wrestled with.
Thank you. As a representative from Florida, I am very concerned about the misuse of funding authority that was designed to aid the anti-drug efforts. And following up on Mr. Schiff's questions, Mr. Ishimoto, you stated in your report that BATF believed that a drug nexus was needed to obtain this military support, and you later stated that this drug nexus was tenuous at best. Were you provided access to information that the drug nexus was false, and when you wrote your report? If you did have the information, why was it not addressed in your report, and if you did not have it, are you now aware of that fact?
Okay. Do we still have time?
Yes, you may answer
you
the
may
question.
Answer. Okay.
She's asking it. It'll be her last question, and your response will be the last thing she gets.
Thank you, Mr. McCollum.
Make it good, Mr. Ishimoto.
What I saw in my review was that ATF had a basis for investigating a drug nexus. It was turning out to be very weak, in my opinion. I believe that they were then reliant upon their military advisor at ATF headquarters, their advisor in JTF 6, Colonel Browning out of the Pentagon, and most importantly, a person out of the Texas Governor's Office who was federally funded employee, and who I believe encouraged ATF to proceed with non-reimbursable use of the military using a drug nexus as a criteria.
Thank you very much, Ms. Ross-Layton. And Mr. Lantos.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Taking my clue from Mr. Zelif that this is a morning of understatement, since he called Koresh not a nice person, I will say this was not a perfect operation. But I would like to move to an entirely different arena. It seems to me that we are living in the past when we draw very sharp lines of distinction between what are military threats and what are civilian threats and the appropriate use of the military. I just want to mention a handful of items. I'd be grateful for a response. In Jonestown, with a violent sect, 900 Americans lost their lives. 900 Americans lost their lives. In Tokyo, given the activities of a violent sect, Amshin Rikyo, which pumped poison gas into the subway system, we had death and we had large numbers of injuries. At the World Trade Center, a violent sect created tremendous human and physical damage. Here, while some are concerned with the appropriateness of the warrants, I am concerned about the fundamental human rights violations and outrages that were involving children, 10-year-old children. I wonder if we are not repeating the tragic example in the Second World War of the guns of Singapore, which were all aimed at the water, but the enemy came from behind, overland. This criticism that the military was involved and focusing on whether it is involved in a reimbursable or non-reimbursable fashion at a time when we are spending $300 billion to protect the lives of American citizens, I think is nothing short of absurd. Of course we need to involve the military when the lives of American citizens and their torture and their rape is at stake. I would like to ask the whole panel, beginning with Mr. Ishimoto, whether you think there is not a pressing need to recognize that we are living in an era of nuclear weapons, biological and chemical weapons, means of mass destruction which can be obtained by violent sects here or abroad. And isn't it necessary, therefore, to integrate our military on a routine basis in fighting these threats?
Sir, you pose a very crucial issue, and it is my belief that it is we must strike a very distinct balance between the use of the military in outright civil law enforcement, which would be a violation of posse comitatus.
Of course.
And the use of the military in terms of assisting law enforcement or federal emergency management agency officials in response to acts of weapons of mass destruction.
That distinction is a legitimate but obvious distinction. You don't want to use the military with respect to traffic violations. But what happens if potentially hundreds of American citizens, as was the case in Jonestown, Guyana, are facing murder, mass murder? There was no way of dealing with it on a civilian basis. There is no way of dealing with a Japanese sect which pumps poison gas into their subway system. Go ahead, sir.
I would agree, sir, and that is a legitimate use of the military under those circumstances. The military, to do a good job, needs to be involved in some planning activities prior to that, and that needs to be reviewed in terms of appropriations, actions, and other planning at.
Any other member of the panel wishes to comment? Could you get the mic closer?
Yes, I'm sorry. First, I'd like to point out that there are legitimate uses for military support in civilian law enforcement operations, and there are also precedents for those support without involving narcotics. I'll cite two examples very quickly. In 1973, the siege at Wounded Knee. In 1975, the murder of two FBI agents on the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation.
That's right.
We used military equipment, but it was operated by FBI agent operators, and that's where the distinction was drawn in order to avoid violation of posse comitatus. I think that, that there are certain categories, potentials for crime and terrorism in this country that portend such grievous consequences that we do have to consider the use of the military, partly because of their specialized assets, for instance, in chemical and biological warfare.
Exactly.
And also because of their resources, such as armor, in certain situations. I think we have to be very cautious about casually accepting military units as police units, however.
Absolutely. Any other comment?
Mr. Lantos, your time is up at this point.
Will you allow the witnesses to respond to the question?
If there is a response, yes.
If they choose to.
I would just like to say that the civilian law enforcement works extensively with the military in mitigation for natural disasters or local emergencies, and that there is ongoing training, logistics, ability to obtain logistics. In the case of the scenario you developed for a nuclear, biological, or chemical incidents of terrorism or extortion or threats along that line, the FBI is clearly the lead agency and has established some very effective task forces in the major metropolitan areas and bringing in the escalation where the military equipment is needed. I think that those programs are well defined within this country. I think the expanded role of the FBI has been well communicated in the major local law enforcement arenas, and I think that if this committee wants to look at that as a side issue, that's another one, but that's a full study in and of itself.
Any other witness responses? Mr. Yes. Sanders?
Mr. Landos, With respect to the question, should the military become involved in civilian law enforcement, I don't think the microphone's working. My answer to that would be no, with the exception of social work and hazardous situations where the military can provide assistance, yes. But in terms of involvement in civilian law enforcement, until the domestic tranquility of this country reaches a level where the military is required, I would be very much opposed to it.
Any other responses, Mr. Ishimoto?
Yes, sir. I would respectfully disagree with my cohort. The military had to be involved in the Detroit riots in Little Rock, Arkansas, for enforcement of certain civil rights laws. And these were national emergencies which far exceeded the capability of any federal or local law enforcement entity to undertake.
Thank you. Thank you, panel, and thank you, Mr. Lantos.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Ross-Layton, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Mr. Ishimoto, following up on our conversation about the drug nexus, we have in our committee notes from someone who appears to have worked or continues to work with ATF, and this was just given to us in a loose form. And let me read to you a few of the sentences here. It seems to be a memo from someone. Use of the National Guard was a scam, in my opinion, to my knowledge. There was never any mention of it, of a meth lab being on the compound. This was a scam initiated by the Bureau's headquarters, again, in my opinion, to obtain the additional resources of the National Guard, air support assistance, etc. In addition, it would mean additional funding for ATF, etc., in the years to come. Could you comment on this drug nexus connection, and whether you think that at the time there was some discussion about the false connection?
Ma'am, in our review, I could not find any deliberate attempt or any attempt at all to lie on ATF's part about a drug nexus. They
Are you aware now that that drug connection was false? Are you aware of that now?
Yes.
You are aware.
But initially, they had evidence that, or from an interview of Mark Burrow, that in fact there was a meth lab there in 1987.
Right, and so they were using false, outdated information from 5 years before. And is that why, in your report, you do not talk about that false drug nexus? Because
they were using outdated information, and then, as I stated previously, this member of the Texas Governor's Office, I believe, was somewhat overzealous in proposing that ATF did, in fact, still have evidence that a meth lab existed on the compound. When the National Guard did an overflight using some very unsophisticated forward-looking infrared devices, and this individual by the name of Eni declared to ATF that that was sufficient.
And you're talking about an individual in the Texas governor's office?
Yes.
Who was this individual?
Mr. William Eni.
Mr. William?
Eni.
Eni. And what did Mr. Eni say?
He indicated to the ATF that that was sufficient for him to declare that a meth lab existed there, and that...
The information from 5 years before?
No. This was an overflight done in early 1993, where they used forward-looking infrared to detect a so-called hotspot on the compound. That hotspot could have come from any number of heat sources, but Mr. Eni chose to interpret that as being indicative of a meth lab.
And is that individual's name in your report, or that nexus? I could not find it in your report.
His name does not appear in my report. For a variety of reasons.
Well, among those?
I was concerned over liability issues.
Good luck to you in that. Continuing about the, in your report, talking about the failure to observe operational security and secrecy, how would you evaluate that failure when we have reports that ATF agents walked around Waco wearing ATF jackets, hats. There was an 80 vehicle convoy which stretched for more than a mile long, included many vehicles which had telltale signs of government vehicles from Fort Hood to Waco that Koresh may have been tipped off indirectly by a reporter. Could you comment on the operational security and secrecy factor of this operation?
Yes, ma'am. I certainly believe in hindsight that they could have planned it better. However, I must emphasize that operation security is always a trade-off at best. And what really caused, in my estimation, the raid to fail was the fact that the ambulance service dispatcher revealed with intention to her boyfriend, a TV news cameraman, as to the fact that ATF and National Guard were planning to hit the compound.
Is it your estimation that that the agents, those in command, lacked the proper training and for this sized operation?
Yes, ma'am, again in hindsight. And I believe they are taking steps to actively improve their training.
Thank you.
Ms. Ross-Lighton, your time is up. Mr. Conyers, if you would like, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to yield initially to the gentleman from New York, Mr. Schumer.
I thank the gentleman. I'd just like to make one point that relates to what we had said earlier, and I appreciate the panel's indulgence. We had a discussion, you were here, for documents not being produced, being produced, both sides sort of revealing everything. Well, I have been informed now that the Department of Justice will turn over all documents that have been requested by the majority, including the documents about Webb Hubble. There are no missing documents. They're making good on all the requests, the request on 712 of Mr. Klinger, the request on 716 of Mr. Charles, and there are no gaps. And the only point I would make is, if we want everything to come out, bringing everything in the fullest light, nobody should hold back anything, and we still very strongly feel that we would like to be interviewing the witnesses related to the NRA and related to those issues. And I yield back the rest of the time to Mr. Conyers, just making the final point that, again, what's good for the goose is good for the gander. Big cries on the other side, White House, reveal all documents, bring everything forward, they did. We make the same pitch to the majority.
Well, it's our hope that this information will lead us to a conclusion rapidly around the question of NRA participation in the investigation. We hope that that can be as efficiently concluded as the matter that you brought to our attention. I don't have questions for this panel because most of you were reviewers at best after the fact on the Waco tragedy, and others of you have jobs that are in agencies that touch on this. It seems to be important that we do acknowledge the fact that frequently the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms coordinates with the Drug Enforcement Administration or with other parts of the Department of Justice or with the Department of Treasury, and there's nothing unusual depending on the subject matters and the activities that are the object of your investigations. That is to say that sometimes there are guns involved, sometimes there are drugs involved, sometimes there may be immigration matters involved, so that the kind of coordination that occurred at Waco is really not unusual from the kind of activities that you normally engage in. Is that a fair assumption of the relationships that went on between different law enforcement agencies in the Waco incident? Mr. Ishimoto, could you respond to that, please?
Yes, sir. That is normal, and perhaps one could criticize ATF for the need to increase the amount of coordination that was done, but they certainly did coordinate with a variety of federal as well as local and state law enforcement agencies.
Mm-hmm. Are there any other comments about the kind of coordination and cooperation that frequently occurs Mr. Coons?
Mr. Conyers, my relationship with ATF has always been a very, very professional, and they accord themselves in that manner.
Yes, sir, my experience has been the same, and we bring in elements of the various agencies whenever necessary for expertise, whether it's ongoing case investigation. My experience in Los Angeles is that we have developed systems to ensure that we're not conflicting with one another on investigation so that we don't expose undercover agents, for example, to jeopardy of a raid. We make sure that our agencies know which one is the lead agency. If we have a need to move faster on a case because of some new development, we go to the agency that had the initial investigation, whether it involves guns, drugs, and work out a compromise for moving up a timetable, for example, of arrest or search warrants. That type of cooperation is extremely critical, and I would support Mr. Ishimoto's comment that if there was any error here, it may have been by not having greater cooperation or coordination, particularly using the resources of the Customs.
Thank you very much, Mr. Conyers. Your time is up. Mr. Coble, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, I yield 5 minutes to the gentleman from New Hampshire, Chairman Zeloff.
Thank you, my colleague, and Mr. Chairman, I'd like to just refer my first question to Mr. Ishimoto, and document that was given to you along the lines of questioning Mrs. Ross Layton. Use of the National Guard was a scam. In my opinion, to my knowledge, there was never any mention of a meth lab being on the compound. This was a scam initiated by Bureau headquarters, again, and in my opinion, to obtain the additional resources of the National Guard. Air support, assistance, et cetera. In addition, it would mean additional funding for ATF in the years to come. Your comment.
Again, Mr. Zeloff, I would disagree with those comments. I saw no collusion on the part of ATF headquarters whatsoever. With response to your colleague's question previously, my indication came from an interview of Mr. Sherbin, who described the results of Mr. Eney's involvement at some time in approximately December and January, where he pushed forward the fact that, in his Eney's belief, that there was a meth lab there, and that was sufficient to engender National Guard support.
Mr. Coons, you're familiar with a methamphetamine lab, and you've got experience with DEA. You were involved with such labs in Central Texas, is that correct?
Yes, sir, I have been.
Can you quickly describe the top three dangers involved with drug enforcement of these labs?
Somebody firing at you upon entry, the possibility of explosion or leakage with respect to the chemicals involved, and the safety of the individuals.
So they're explosive in nature, there's also toxic?
Yes, sir, they are.
And there's this pretty strong stench or smell that goes with it, some of those chemicals, or not, if there's a lab existing?
Sir, it depends on which formula you're using. But normally in a methamphetamine lab in that area of the country, you have to make another controlled substance prior to the manufacture of methamphetamine, which is called phenylacetone. And that's very obnoxious, very odorous.
So you'd know pretty conclusively if there was a lab there, probably.
Well, you have to combine the smell or the odors along with other probable cause that you develop during the course of the investigation.
Okay. Tell me the special training that's required for any enforcement official to be involved in a takedown of these kind of labs.
The entry team, Mr. Zella?
Pardon?
The entry team, sir?
The entry team. If you're involved in a takedown of the lab,
you have to be very knowledgeable about the processes involved so you can make a determination as exactly to what's going on within the lab when you get in there. You have to be familiar with the chemicals. You have to be OSHA certified.
Okay. Will the clerk pass out a document to all members of the panel marked number one? Just take a quick look at it. I want you to take a look at that. This is an operational order from DOD for military assistance to the ATF for the Branch Davidian raid. I'm going to read you the quote in that document. And I quote, intelligence indicates an active methamphetamine lab and deliveries of the required chemicals to produce synthetic methamphetamine. Mr. Kuntz, does the DEA use FRIR heat sensing devices to identify these labs?
FLIR is one element of probable cause which would support other elements of probable cause that you established during the course of your investigation.
Okay, and would you read the part that's underlined that's been handed out to you? Intelligence indicates an active?
Nothing's underlined. Sorry, I don't see anything that's underlined.
Okay, I'll read it then. Intelligence indicates an active methamphetamine lab and deliveries of the required chemicals to produce the synthetic methamphetamines. If someone thought that there was an active lab with precursor chemicals, what agency would be the lead agency in any law enforcement action in such a lab?
Well, certainly we have a lot of expertise, Mr. Zeloff, but that's not to say that other state, local, or federal law enforcement agencies couldn't affect the seizure of an operational methamphetamine lab.
So DEA would not necessarily be called in on anything related to this kind of operation?
Sometimes they're not notified. That's correct.
Were they ever contacted by ATF to be involved in a Mont Carmel Center takedown?
Sir, I don't know the answer to that question.
Would you be willing for the record to get that information for us?
Yes, sir, I will.
And I'll leave it at that. My time's run out.
This time, I believe Ms. Jackson Lee, you are next on the list and recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Let me say to all the witnesses that I appreciate your appearance here, and if I miss the opportunity to ask any one of you questions, it's not because there's not an interest. Although I might add, in reading the report by the Treasury Department, I can basically say that to date there is no new information. However, I think it is important that we are in these proceedings because it is important for the American people to be able to be carried through this process and understand what happened and what did not happen. Now, we're now into the area dealing with military involvement. The military involvement that we're talking about falls in two different areas. One, Mr. Ishimoto, if you would listen to me on this, dealt with the ATF not having to reimburse for military usage. And so the drug nexus was attempted to develop a nexus so you would not have to be reimbursed. However, Customs, another federal agency that is not in the military or not military agency, had helicopters. So there were other options. So I really think the key has to be, one, the acknowledgement that was in the report already, that nexus fell short. Let us acknowledge that. It fell short primarily because we started with the 1987 understanding that the previous god, if you will, Mr. Roden, had a metamethamphetamine machine of sorts. That was the basis. And then not being able to trace where that particular equipment was, they began to develop, as I understand it, a basis by way of former drug users, just like you can have a former alcoholic, maybe not making a bootleg wine in there. But in any event, former drug users, that was the beginning of the nexus. My question to you, Mr. Ishimoto, was one, did you already discover that in your review, and was that not in the Treasury Department's report as a reviewer? Did you discover that as you were reviewing?
Yes, ma'am. We discovered that as we reviewed the incident.
As we proceed with that line of questioning, you indicated that this raid had a reasonable chance of success. It was nevertheless not well conceived. Can you give me briefly a explanation of that, please?
I refer to my previous testimony in terms of why it had a chance to succeed in my mind. And it deals with the nine basic principles. What could have been done better would have been to expand the planning efforts to cover other contingencies and to establish their critical success factors and to task their forward observers with reporting normal activity at the compound rather than the questions that Mr. Sherbin did ask of Agent Rodriguez, which were, do you see anyone in the windows? And did you see them getting ready for us?
So that was a key, and it related to the element of surprise as well, I believe.
Yes,
that
ma'am.
Was very, very important. Let me go back again to the drug nexus and that whole scenario that was reported again in the Treasury Department's report. The question of using the Texas National Guard to do the hot spots or do the infrared, as I understand it, and then getting the analysis, would you not add or would you not reinforce, which was in the report again, that the difficulty was that there was a sort of speculative or kind of layman's review of those documents, even though we give credit to the Texas National Guard for having some expertise, and it didn't ultimately go to a lab to determine whether those were actually suggestions of drug-making equipment. Is that my understanding? Do I have that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
So that certainly should be something that should be corrected if ever utilized, that there be a period where we don't just speculate and have the documents reviewed around a table of people that may not have total expertise, but that we have a final determination by those equipped to determine bottom line in order to make that determination. Is that?
I very much agree with
would
you.
Would that be a correction that we would have? There was some discussion yesterday about the equipment that the ATF used, and let me reinforce the tragedy of the loss of life. I don't think we can get away from that, and let me also reinforce that we should be here to unfold the story for the American people. But there was some suggestion of the gear and the equipment. Being in law enforcement or involved in this arena, have you seen an increase in the kind of technology and weapons that criminals have had, meaning the massive machinery, the grenades, the automatic weapons? Would that then be a response, or a response be, that law enforcement then has to enhance its technology, whether it be in terms of dress and fatigues and the type of boot wear that was being worn? Could that be in response to the kind of equipment that those who engage in criminal activities might have?
Yes, ma'am, that is certainly part of the response, and the other part of it is that as people have looked at dynamic entry tactics, a certain appearance assists in less use of lethality, if that makes any sense.
By could you repeat that again? I'm sorry, I know you're finishing your answer.
By having a certain kind of appearance, in other words, wearing certain kinds of helmets and tactical vests and black uniforms, then it intimidates a lot of people and causes them to use less lethal force in opposition to those making the raid.
Thank you. I may have a chance to get back with you, Mr. Smoe. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Jackson-Lee. At this point in time, I think we're down there to recognize Mr. Booyer. 5 minutes.
I yield to the gentleman, Mr. Plain Talk of North Carolina. My 5 minutes to Howard Coble.
I thank the gentleman for yielding. Mr. Chairman, the gentleman from Oklahoma correctly noted last night that some people are playing roles in this hearing, and I feel obliged to say that implications have swirled around this hearing room, indicating that those who are advocating the desirability of illuminating additional facts surrounding the raid are in some way sympathetic to Koresh. I think no one believes this, but it makes for provocative talk. And I want to say, if this guy had approached me, not only would I not have signed on with him, but I signed off with him. But that judgment obviously is not universally prevailing because we know some folks signed on with him. Having said that, that'll be for another day to get into more detail. But I appreciate you all being here, gentlemen. Mr. Coots, let me revisit what the chairman said to you earlier concerning the methamphetamine lab, or either the presence of it or the lack of it. Talk to me a little in more detail about the OSHA certification. Do you know whether or not any of the agents during that raid were in fact OSHA certified?
No, sir, I don't.
Could you, we're going to keep you busy doing homework, but I think that might well be information that we need to know. Can you obtain that information for us?
I'll do my best for you, sir.
And if you can, Mr. Coons, in a very brief manner, what constitutes OSHA certification?
Basically, you have to go through a two-week certification program dealing with the chemicals that are involved in the regulations as far as disposal in the hazards in the equipment utilized to identify those areas inside a clandestine drug laboratory.
Mr. Coons, have you seen the videotapes of the ATF raid on the compound?
Very briefly, sir.
Well, you may not recall. I was just wondering if having said what you just said earlier, if the agents conducted the raid appeared to be taking the necessary precautions, that is to say gloves and masks, that would normally be acceptable in taking down such a lab?
Sir, I really couldn't comment or give you an honest answer because I wasn't there.
Okay. I thought perhaps if you had seen that and observed the videotape, that might put you in a position. Okay. Mr. Bassett, we have heard much talk about dynamic entry. That's been kicked around very prominently and frequently. This is a general question, but under what conditions is a dynamic entry appropriate?
Well, to begin with, I would agree with my colleague, Mr. Ishimoto, that dynamic tactics can be used to reduce risk upon entry into otherwise high-risk situations. However, dynamic tactics are high-risk tactics. They're high-risk not only in the sense of the situations in which they would be employed, but also the very training that people have to go through in order to gain competency in dynamic tactics involves risk in and of itself. Dynamic tactics involve very rapid entry, fail-safe entry, rapid continuous forward movement with a great deal of speed, the ability to fire on the move, which is a skill that is it takes time to learn, and it also takes time to maintain it in terms of training. Dynamic tactics require people who are very well trained and who are very well prepared for their execution. They were originally applied in this country for hostage rescue, where there was compelling need to conduct tactical interventions in order to rescue people who were in danger of grievous bodily harm.
It seems to me I'll let you say what it seems to you. Would this be an optimal type of entry in a building large in size, occupied, as someone mentioned earlier, by probably 100 men, women, and children, heavily armed? Would that it seems to me, would not be an optimal entry. What say you to that?
The risks involved in any set of tactics have to be weighed against the necessity for their implementation, for the implementation of the tactics. In my view, there would have had to be compelling necessity extant in order to take the risks that were inherent in this operation.
Thank you, Mr. Bassett. Mr. Coos, one final question. Does the DEA have any standing operating procedure about a FLIR signature of a meth lab?
Not that I'm aware of.
I think I have no more questions. Gentlemen, thank you all for being here. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Cole. Mr. Cummins, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I, too, would like to welcome the witnesses and thank them for being here today. I'd like to maybe just focus for a few minutes that I have on this so-called drug nexus. And Mr. Ishimoto, maybe you could respond for me, and if there's time, maybe the other witnesses can as well. Are you aware of, is there any other examples by which the military has been brought in or asked to come in on under these kinds of circumstances where there has been some suspicions, someone has suspected that there is drugs involved? I mean, it appears to me that they came in with very little concrete information, that there were no standards by which they judged their involvement. Is this a practice that's going on in other parts of the country where ATF or other local law enforcement agencies can sort of bait the military to come in to get their equipment, to get their personnel there? Are you aware of that in any other parts of the country?
Yes, sir. I should predicate it by saying that there is a review process conducted in the Department of Defense at several levels in order to ensure that the support rendered is proper.
There is a review process by DOD.
Yes, sir.
Was the review process done in this case?
To the best of my knowledge, sir, because I have seen signed memorandums from Colonel Brown, Judith Browning, who is in charge of the counter-narcotics effort within the Army at that point in time. And I have seen other documents signed by the ATF military liaison.
So in your report, you recommended that we have standards by which the military gets involved. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Are those standards that you're recommending in your report go beyond this review process, or is it the same as the review process?
It is essentially the same as the review process. In my estimation, there was perhaps a breakdown.
Anyone else wish to comment to that?
In dealing with the National Guard, for example, in California, we have a memorandum of agreement as to what equipment will be used, how it will be used, who is in control of the equipment, and under what conditions it can be used. Appropriate executive level of a local law enforcement agency or a regional task force is one element on that MOA and has a counterpart in the State National Guard. For the most part, these are standing agreements, and the use of military equipment, for example, in overflight, is to augment existing investigative efforts and is more of an ongoing program as opposed to a single incident program. In the case of a single incident program within California, use of the National Guard equipment, there would have to be a compelling reason to use that, and that would be the first point of contact, not the federal military.
Well, I'm a bit surprised that Mr. Ishimoto, that you say the standards were met, because it appears that there's very minimal evidence that there might be drugs being produced there, sold there, used there, et cetera. That really surprises me that you say that the review process was adequate under the circumstances.
Sir, I did not say it was adequate. I said that the process was followed, and I believe that there certainly was a breakdown, but that breakdown is not necessarily on the part of ATF. I would look to the military review process and to see if that was adequate.
Would it been appropriate for the ATF to, before it moved for military help, if they thought they had a massive drug operation here or any kind of minimal drug operation, ask the DEA to be involved, since the DEA, sort of, this is their area of expertise?
If the primary violation was drugs, I would certainly say so. In this case, the primary violation that ATF was investigating and attempting to serve the warrants on dealt with firearms and explosive violations.
That may be correct, but it's my understanding that they got the military involved in this issue based on the suspicion that there was drugs being made at the facility.
Sir, let me clarify that. They got non-reimbursable support from the military and the Texas National Guard. Because of a drug nexus, they could have received military support on a reimbursable basis.
My time's up. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Condit. At this time, I yield to Mr. Shattuck.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and it's my distinct privilege to yield my time back to you, sir.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Shattuck, and I will start the 5 minutes here. I want to direct my questions mostly to you, Mr. Bassett, for some specific reasons. I understand that you've been with the FBI or were with the FBI for more than 30 years. Is that correct? If you could turn your mic on, please.
I'd like to correct the record. My tenure with the FBI was for slightly over 23 years, sir.
Well, that's still a pretty good period of time. We'll accept that. And during that time, did you head the crisis management team there?
I was responsible for the FBI's crisis management program for the last 5 years of my career, yes, sir.
What is that? What was that?
The crisis management program in the FBI is a program which is an umbrella for various components of what one could call special operations facet of FBI operations.
And if you'd had an opportunity or need for something such as the raid or a siege of a compound like at Waco under the FBI's supervision during your tenure there, you would have been the one who would have headed the planning operation for that. Is that correct?
Not necessarily, no. I could have been involved in the planning and the operation and as a consultant, but the actual planning would occur on the part of people in the field.
But you were in charge of the team itself, or the program, the development of that program.
I was responsible for the program, yes, sir.
So, in essence, you have quite a background, is what I'm getting at, in looking at this type of situation in terms of the type of operations that might or might not be involved in Waco. Is that not correct?
I spent a good part of my career in specializing in this type of operation, yes, sir.
Now, Mr. Bassett, you've already said today that you didn't think that this was the optimal method of going in and having a raid in the situation we've had today. Isn't it true that a dynamic entry like the one we're talking about that the ATF tried to perform on the 28th of February of 93 is the most dangerous type of tactic to employ and requires a lot of advanced training? Isn't that true?
That's a relative notion. It can reduce risk if the people who are executing or implementing the raid are properly trained. The planning has been properly done based on good intelligence.
But it is more dangerous than most types of things they do. I mean, if you're going to go out and have a siege, it's more dangerous than a siege, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
All right. Weren't the roads that were open and leading to this compound, the fact they were all open and there was a lack of cover, a factor that would dictate against that type of operation in Waco?
The exposure of the approaching raid teams was a major problem at Waco, in my estimation. Particularly the fact that it funneled the approaching agents into a position where they simply could not retreat from and at the same time defend themselves. They couldn't turn their vehicles around as they approached the compound.
Having looked at this matter as you have, what would be your opinion as to the preferred method of having approached this as opposed to this dynamic entry?
I would have to go back to the notion of intelligence once again, and hope that intelligence gathering had been more rigorous, that more attention had been paid to the intelligence prior to the time the option to raid was selected. In other words, looking more studiously at the prospect of arresting Mr. Koresh away from the compound and thereby removing him as the commander, so to speak, of the cult population.
You believe that arresting Mr. Koresh away from the compound was a critical missing element in this situation?
I believe that it could have greatly reduced the risks attendant to the service of the arrest and the search warrants, yes, sir.
And you would have preferred probably to try the siege rather than to do this entry or not?
The entry as it was planned and attempted, I think, was riskier than a siege would have been, yes, sir.
Now, there's been a lot of innuendo that a siege might have resulted in suicides or whatever inside there. That, of course, is a factor in all of this. Did you take that into account, or have you taken that into account?
Yes, sir, I have. And, of course, I have to point out that my observations are in hindsight, and looking back at what the planners
of course
knew at the time.
But would you have gotten some religious expertise, some expertise in psychiatric and so forth, more than ATF did before you made the determination to go with a dynamic entry as opposed to a siege? Would you have done some of that type of intelligence gathering?
That would certainly be incorporated in the type of intelligence gathering that would have reduced the risk greatly in this operation.
But most importantly, you would have gotten Mr. Koresh if you could have. That would have been your first central focus, to arrest him outside that compound. Is that correct?
That's correct, sir. Yes.
And that was not done in this case. Thank you very
That's
much.
Correct.
At this time, my time is up, but I yield to Ms. Lofgren 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I am very interested in how we can review this situation and make sure that our country does a better job in the future of dealing with the cult situation such as this that we could face in the future. And I'm interested in the multidisciplinary team approach and how that might yield more suitable or positive results in the future. In terms of who was there and the multidisciplinary nature of the serving of the warrant itself and the entry in April, Mr. Ishimoto, were there DEA agents there at the raid in the course of your review? Did you find that?
Ma'am, I'm not sure if they were on site. It is my recollection that at least one was.
and that the DEA was asked to have people on site by ATF.
And that was like to advise where to use the flashbangs to keep away from the, if they thought there was a meth lab, to avoid explosion or that sort of thing?
No, I'm not sure exactly what their role was supposed to be.
Okay, and were there INS agents present or?
That I do not recall.
As I review it, and we can talk about the day of the raid itself and the dynamic entry, but stepping back a ways, by the time the raid occurred, I think a lot was known or strongly suspected about what was going on inside that compound. And although the information might not have been in a form that could have been used to obtain a warrant, for example, a warrant had already been obtained, a valid warrant for the search, the Waco newspapers had printed their series. Agents could easily know from reading those articles that 12-year-old girls were being raped repeatedly, that all the male adult members had been removed from their wives and were celibates, so that Mr. Koresh, the Christ figure, in his own mind, could have all of the children for use sexually, that there was a dire physical abuse underway with babies, and there had been kidnappings, there were immigration violations, little girls who'd crossed state lines. I mean, there's a number of federal law violations present in that article. There are a number of state law violations in terms of the child abuse and the molestations. And I'm wondering whether we have adequate resources and research in the federal government to put together a team that is made up of both federal officials, local officials, mental health specialists, and whether the raid itself, and I'm looking backwards, and I know that the people who were involved yesterday will always live with the result of the raid. Hindsight's 20/20, but looking ahead in the future, whether mental health professionals and a different approach might have yielded a different result. Do you have a professional opinion on that, Mr. Ishimoto?
Yes, it's a very tough issue. For years, the behavioral science unit at the FBI's National Academy or Training Academy, where Mr. Bassett used to work, has looked into matters of that sort. ATF, in fact, was one of the first contributors to assign agents to the FBI Academy to assist the behavioral science unit in trying to look at these kinds of folks that they deal with. But it is a very contentious issue and one that I certainly believe deserves further investigation.
Mr. Morrison, this is maybe unfair to ask you because it's not your department, but early, and according to the Waco paper in August of 1990, the Pomona Police Department became aware that a 2-year-old had been kidnapped to Texas, and that a 12-year-old girl who was from Australia had been, after the kidnapped child was returned, had been moved to Texas and was being abused. That, apparently that was known to them. I don't want to criticize the officers, but standard operating procedure in the L.A. Basin, in your professional judgment, what would ordinarily happen with a fact situation like that? Was it a glitch? Would ordinarily proper procedure be to ask the FBI to pursue the transport of the child across state lines? Or what would generally be expected? That didn't happen then. Had it, maybe a lot of things might not have happened down the line.
I can't give you specific responses because I'm not familiar with each aspect of the case. I can talk generically about that. In the case of missing children, if it's beyond a child custody case where you have specific principals involved, it is common in the Los Angeles Basin for the law enforcement agencies to join forces. If there's a belief that there is a cult operation or any conspiratorial act to do that, in those cases, we would work with the FBI or any other federal agency that might have a jurisdiction in the case. I think that what your question leads to specifically as to Waco, trying to come back into the focus on that, is the need for the case management review and the intelligence analytical review in major cases of this nature. The same thing would be true in serial murder or rape cases. You bring in as many of the disciplines as you possibly can, and any agency that is willing to cooperate upon invitation or request, whether or not they have jurisdiction. There are limitations as to the criminal jurisdiction in cases that will prevent either state, local, or federal agency from becoming involved in anything other than an advisory capacity because they do not have the investigative authority, perhaps, given by law. So I'm kind of covering the whole base, but that's basically what you're dealing with there. If you have a specific missing child complaint, that is up to the jurisdiction that initially has it. If they believe there's an interstate involvement, they would go probably to the FBI. To the extent that it's conspiratorial in nature and that there is an activity in another state, they would the local law enforcement agency would then go to that state and try and work with the agency there to help them follow up their leads.
Thank you.
Time is up. Mr. Klinger, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would just like to thank the panel for their participation and their testimony and yield the balance of my time to Chairman Zella.
Thank you, Mr. Klinger. Mr. Coons, we were talking earlier about the danger of taking down a meth lab and the things that you have to be aware of in terms of caution. What's your reaction of combining a takedown of a meth lab with a dynamic entry raid?
The only thing I can say, Congressman, is that each laboratory is different, and you have to take all of the facts and all the probable cause and the circumstances and then make a decision at the time, because each one of these laboratories is different. There's something always different about these laboratories.
Well, I guess I would ask a question of everybody on the panel, since you had the opportunity to, after the fact, review what happened at Waco. Any of you believe that there was any drug connection at all at Waco?
I can't answer that question, Congressman, because I don't have that information, nor have I reviewed it.
I do not believe that there was any drug connection.
Okay.
My opinion is based purely on the public record, and I haven't seen any indication of a drug
Mr. Morrison?
Nexus.
I don't believe so. I think it was considered and rejected, and it was not part of the planning element for the raid to consider a confrontation with the meth lab.
Okay. Mr. Bassett?
I have no factual basis to believe one way or the other, sir, but my understanding is that there was no drug connection.
Okay. Thank you very much. I want to respond to Mrs. Schumer's 12th-hour announcement that all documents will now be produced by Treasury to Congress. We appreciate that very much. Today, of course, is July 20th. Our first full document request was on June 8th. And I think those dates and the difference between the two sets of dates speak for themselves. Second, the missing Webster-Hubble telephone diaries are not obviously going to come from Treasury. They must come from Justice. At this point, we have most of Mr. Hubble's messages, including both from to and from the White House, including one from Mrs. Clinton between March 1st, 1993 and April 30th, 1993. However, we are still missing Webster Hubble's telephone notes and messages for at least 4 days, April 16th, April 17th, April 18th, and April 19th. You'll recognize the significance of those dates. These logs include Hubble's communications with the White House and within the Justice Department, which is why they're very important. If these documents are now on their way, I'd be happy to hear that. And since you raised it, Mrs. Schumer, we really appreciate any assistance that you could provide. I'll raise the issue again and again on your suggestion. If we do not get them, we would appreciate getting them before Mr. Hubble's testimony. Let me add that this is just one fact that we're talking about in terms of cooperation of documents. We received at one point 13,000 loose and unindexed pieces of paper from the initial Treasury production. That's quite, you know, it admittedly, they did a piece of the project, but it was not well organized, and it was certainly not very helpful in the way it was presented. We just got 6 new boxes, thousands of field documents yesterday. And I want you to know that I've tried to get cooperation from all agencies, and it is getting a little bit better, but not complete yet. And the hearings are definitely on the way. This is day 2. Anything you can get to the bottom of the missing documents before the hearing is over would be greatly appreciated. Thank you. Now yield back the balance of my time. I yield back the balance of my time to Mrs. Rusley.
Thank you so much.
the gentleman yield so I could answer his question?
I just have such very limited time, and I'm sure that the next questioner will be glad to do that.
And I would ask just before the gentlelady, since we're on this
of
subject,
course.
I would ask unanimous consent. I'd be given 2 minutes just to deal with some of the questions that Mr. Zeliff brought up.
If that's going to be taken out of this time,
no, no,
though,
no.
Mr.
Unanimous consent, not out
Chairman,
of your time.
Without objection, time. So ordered.
I thank the gentleman.
The gentlelady still has a minute and about 20 seconds.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
What I'd say is every time that the majority has made a request
Wait. You want to do it now. There are 2 minutes now?
Yes, I'd like to do it now. It just follows.
I yield to you.
Thank the gentleman. And he always is fair, as I have said. Every time the gentleman and the majority has asked for documents from the White House, from Treasury, from others, they've been given every single document. They ask for one group, then they want another. They ask for another, and then they get a third. Here are these. These are the documents, Mr. Zeliff. They've been sent to you, but I'll give them to you. Every single phone call that Webb Hubble has made from, please, it's my time and I'll yield to you when I'm finished. Every single phone call from Webb Hubble, because they love to bring in the name Webb Hubble, from the White House to Justice with Injustice is here. Yes, there are lots of pages. We've given you 13, the administration's given you 13,000. Here they are. Take them.
Could the gentleman from the Department of Justice please come in?
He's getting the same one.
Are you delivering them for someone else?
No, you've gotten the same package, but you refuse to say it. We've all gotten it. Myself, Ms. Thurman, yourself, and Mr. McCollum. But you can have mine, because I know there's nothing there. But we keep making an issue. What I find so ironic is we keep making an issue of Justice Department documents, of presidential documents, 13,000 of them, everything in them, private meetings with the council where we go over even the president's own personal notes, nothing is found, and then a request for more documents. But when there's something very relevant, yeah, that's because
they're good quality documents.
Yeah, that is the document, because those on that page, there are no calls to the Justice Department and no calls to the White House.
This is you Janet can't Reno's, just subpoena. This is Janet Reno's material right here.
Right, no, that's Webb Hubble. Okay. They cannot get every phone call that you can have your time. Okay? The bottom line is every single call that Webb Hubble has made from Justice and from the White House that has been requested has been given. Not calls that he's made to other things. And I find the majority here, you talk about smoke screens. This is one of the largest I have seen. If they're so interested in complete disclosure from the administration, why can't we have some complete disclosure from the NRA and from the committee staff? What's good for the goose is good for the gander. That is the bottom line.
The gentleman's time has expired. The chair will take note that there were some documents delivered. We haven't examined them. We don't know what's in there. We trust the gentleman's word on that that's what they are, and we'll certainly take a look at them. But I must say, just in one comment, and I'm going to quit and yield back the minute and 20 seconds or whatever to Ms. Leighton that she has, is that we have generally received cooperation from these agencies.
Sure,
but there has been a problem with some of the productions, and that's what this dispute is over. And I do not profess to know whether the produced items resolve that dispute or not. Ms. Ross Leighton, you have a minute and 25 seconds,
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Getting back to the main points of today's hearing, which deal with the inadequate training of the personnel, the poor planning, ATF dynamic entry plan, which was way too risky for both the ATF agents and civilians on the compound, lying about the drug lab. Those are the issues of today. And I'd like to continue asking Mr. Ishimoto about your report. You had stated in your report that the ATF plan did not provide adequately for contingencies. You cite the failure of the ATF to use a fire maneuver and armor to protect and recover their wounded as an example of the poor planning involved. In your estimation, to what degree did this failure to plan for contingencies contribute to the deaths and the injuries of the ATF personnel?
I don't believe it contributed to the death.
Do you
injury.
Believe that it revealed a lack of professionalism in the planning of the raid?
I certainly believe that the professionalism could have been improved.
Could have been improved?
Could have been improved. Yes, ma'am.
I thank the gentlelady. Whatever is up at this point, I'm sorry I have to cut you off at this juncture.
Mr. Taylor, I believe you're next and will be recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank the panel for being with us today. I don't think anyone in this room doubts that the job could have been done better. But I think all of us regret that four good people are dead and another 20 were wounded trying to enforce the laws of this country. I don't think any of you are going to disagree with that. I would like to direct my statements to two in particular, Mr. Ishimoto. A lot has been made of the fact that the Army trained these people for 3 days. Now, according to testimony that I've received in the Armed Services Committee over the years, it takes months, like 4 or 5 months, to even get a National Guard or Reserve Brigade up to deployable status. Is that not correct?
Yes, sir.
So 3 days doesn't make an ATF agent Special Forces, does it?
No, sir. And so they had done training previously.
But I mean, but it's safe to say that when this 20th Special Forces was called up, and I know this personally because they're Mississippians, they all were qualified, Special Forces qualified, 100%, but it took months to do so. Is that not the norm, even for Special Forces reservists?
That is the norm, yes, sir.
Okay, so we've made point one that this isn't a military operation, this is an ATF operation, that people don't have a fear that the military is taking over. Mr. Morrison, I would like to bring to your attention an article that appeared in the local paper the day before the raid. It was written by two reporters who left town on day of the raid, who left town after publishing it, I take for fear of their lives. The paper that reported this changed the security measures at the paper. They put different locks on the doors. They made people get identification passes. And they got the reporters out of town for fear for their lives, okay? No, it's not Waco, it's Los Angeles. And it's not the Branch Davidians, it's maybe the Aryan Nation or maybe even the Black Panthers. And you get a report that people are amassing hundreds of semi-automatic weapons that they're converting to automatic. It's published in the local paper. They're molesting children. They're keeping people against their will for months at a time. And they're compiling a hit list of former members that they once silenced, and the word they used is eliminated. Would you, as the former head of the Los Angeles Police Department Tactical Unit, ignore that? Would you not try to take some steps to protect the people of Los Angeles? And let's keep in mind that unlike a wealthy community like Los Angeles that has its own helicopters, most local communities, including those in South Mississippi, do not. I represent 11 counties. Only one of them can afford the approximately $400,000 a year it costs to get even a surplus helicopter and maintain it and have a qualified pilot. Keeping all these things into account, including on the day of the raid, the day before the raid, I'm sorry, an editorial in the local paper that is calling on law enforcement communities to do something about it. In fact, it quotes, it says, three former cult members flew from Australia last February to testify that Howell had sex with underage girls, abused children, whipped babies as young as 8 months old, turned Mount Carmel into an armed camp and split apart the families and his followers, declaring himself the only perfect mate for the women in the cult. And then later on it talks about the weapons. Later on it talks about the death threats to former members. What would you do? You're a former policeman. You have a paper in your district, if I'm not mistaken, called the Los Angeles Times. What if they'd run the same editorial? Would you ignore it?
No.
What would you have done, sir? What would you, and everybody realizes they should have called off the raid when they were discovered.
Mr. Chairman, with all due respect,
but would you have done nothing?
The context of your question, if you could give me your question in a context that I could answer, I would appreciate it, sir.
So I will. What would you have done differently? Now, and again, I am not an attorney, but even if you arrest Koresh off the premises, can't he post bond and go right back on the premises? And you now have a person. Again, it's not Koresh, it could be the Aryan Nation, it could be the Black Panthers, it could be any group that advocates violence and then mass suicide. What would you do knowing that he could post bail and go right back to this compound?
If you're asking me what would I do based on a newspaper article that was developed on something that I was currently investigating, I would take that information into consideration. It would be part of my case management. I would talk to the, or assign someone to talk to the research investigator or reporters that dealt with that to the extent that they were willing to talk. If they developed new information, I would attempt to add that to my case management or my intelligence if I did not already have that. And that goes back to something that is already contained in the investigative report. I believe that it would be advantageous to ATF to develop new methods of case management, intelligence review and analysis, and update. The purpose of this is to update any information you have before you get involved in a tactical situation. As to your other points that you raised, you're talking about multiple different jurisdictions. The local police agencies and the state agency within Texas had looked at criminal allegations and past complaints and past criminal activities at that location. They had the primary jurisdiction for that. It is my understanding that the ATF aspect of this dealt with the firearms and the explosives at the compound. There had been earlier conversations between the ATF case agents and the investigators from Department of Social Services, from the local county sheriff's office. Those things had taken place. So I'm saying that was ongoing. You're asking me what would I do, and I will come back now and close that and say that I would have enhanced the case management and intelligence analysis review to get closure on any open-ended issues, and I would incorporate that information into any approval that I would give to the tactical plan to do a high-risk forced entry arrest. To your question on getting Mr. Koresh off the grounds, would the arrest off the grounds eliminate the need to later go onto the premises to conduct a raid, to serve a search warrant? The answer is no. Would he be able to get out on bail if he were arrested? In all likelihood, yes, unless it were for a capital offense or something. I'm not familiar with the bail schedule in that particular county or in the state of Texas, and I'm not familiar with the federal bail schedule for the firearms violations. So, the list is endless. I could answer your questions, but there you've added many elements in there, and each one of those deserve an answer, and I really can't answer them in limited time.
And if I may, one last comment. Isn't there a well-publicized case going on right now in your hometown of someone who was apparently getting ready to skip bail?
Who would you be referring to, sir?
It's on CNN every day, sir.
I think the time is up with the gentleman. Thank you very much. I yield 5 minutes to Mr. Shabbat.
Chairman, before yielding my time, I'd like to emphasize the point that was just made a little while ago by the gentleman from North Carolina, Mr. Coble, that all of us on this side of the aisle are disgusted by the behavior of Mr. Koresh, particularly in the area of child abuse. I think it's important that all these facts get out. It's good that the facts get out, but I think that all of us are truly disgusted by what went on in that compound. But Mr. Koresh was not a federal employee, particularly a federal employee that's sworn to protect American citizens. The ATF and the FBI are sworn to protect American citizens, and thus, when something goes as wrong as the raids on February 28th and on April 19th, then it's appropriate that no stone be left unturned, so that we learn from the mistakes that were made at Waco, and so that they're never repeated. Now I yield back the balance of my time to the gentleman from New Mexico, Mr. Schiff.
I thank the gentleman for yielding, and I'd like to follow up both on the comments that he just made and the questioning by the gentleman from Mississippi, Mr. Taylor. Mr. Morrison, I'd like to turn to you, sir, and I have a copy of the report that you wrote as an expert advisor in the Treasury Department investigation of this incident. You said there, and I think you've quoted this before, from your report, the absence of management review led to a serious breach of integrity, falsification of documents. What documents were falsified?
I believe that was in there were two elements there. I'm not going to get into the internal investigation because that is not my jurisdiction or expertise, and I believe there's ongoing administrative review. The falsification came in part unintentionally, and I believe at one point it was indicated to me that there may have been a deliberate falsification, but the fact that information was restricted or removed in what was forwarded to the tactical planners, and putting it into that context, that the people charged with putting together the tactical aspect of this thing did not have the information that was known to other agents within ATF through previous case investigation or intelligence.
Well, if any of this change in documents or withholding of documents took place, would you regard that as a serious matter in a plan like this?
I believe that it is critical that the planners have all information available, and if something has been considered and rejected, that they at least have that knowledge and be aware of that, and that comes into the case management.
Now, you're aware that it's been charged here and apparently substantiated that David Koresh sexually abused young girls. You've heard that, haven't you?
Yes, sir, I have.
Does that change your opinion of the critical nature of the information you just talked about within the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and planning this?
No, sir, that's not what I was referring to.
No, I know that. That's my point. Is there any relation in your mind between the critical nature of the documents that were, if not falsified, withheld as a planning part of this operation and what Mr. Koresh may be doing inside the compound?
I guess I'm having a difficulty understanding the question.
I think that's just because there's a difficulty in seeing why the sensationalist information has been piled in over possible defects of law enforcement. Let me do one more thing. Let me read a quote from your report again, Mr. Morrison, please. You write, after additional preliminary inquiry and research by the review, it was clear that the review's concerns were the same as mine. Brave and dedicated BATF agents and supervisors were louder directed to go in harm's way by substantial management and organizational deficiencies, and in some cases an abdication of authority and responsibility by mid and top level managers. You recognize that statement, sir?
Yes, sir.
And that's out of your report after reviewing this whole incident?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is there any reason to change anything now from what you wrote then?
No, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back to the chair.
Thank you very much. Let's see, is nobody on that side of the aisle. So the next person I go to is Mr. Barr. Mr. Barr, you're recognized if somebody else is ready, Mr. Heineman or Mr. Bryant. Mr. Heineman, would you like to take 5 minutes?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like not to speak to the substantive matters here as much as my observations in the last 2 days. And I sit here and as a 38-year member of law enforcement from 1955 to 1994, the last 15 years as a chief of police, who's had the pleasure of working with governmental agencies, not the least of which is ATF. And I and my colleagues are not here to demonize ATF as an agency, to wit, pulling them apart in front of CNN and C-SPAN. I think the larger thing that I'm concerned about and we should be concerned about here is bringing the truth of Waco and good old boys and Ruby Ridge to the public. Let them see exactly what happened. Because there's a lot of hatred across this country for governmental agencies, for government regulations, not the least of which is borne by the ATF and the FBI. I think it's important for the people to know the truth, not rumor. I read this report that was put out as it relates to the investigation of the Waco incident, as it related to ATF. Some of what I read in there as a written document was contradicted yesterday by at least one member of the panel under oath. I have questions as to what the public was told. I'm here to learn. I'm here to answer questions. I think it's so important. I think there's a lot of frustration out there in the western part of this country as well as the east, that they're not getting a fair deal as far as finding out what's happening with the federal government. I think this is important. It's not important by our colleagues across the aisle who scream about cutting school lunches to bring a 14-year-old girl in here who goes through pain, as her father went through pain yesterday, listening to the sexual exploitations of David Koresh and a 14-year-old child. I was ashamed of us yesterday. I hope in the future we can arrange for in-camera review of these things and shield children from having to go through that. That was disgusting, and I know I'm taking a swipe at my leadership for letting that to happen. We don't need to do that. It didn't matter. We demonized David Koresh amongst ourselves and not for the public. We know that he was a pervert. We know every bit as much as they know how bad he was. We're not here to make a point of that. We're here to make a point of government operations. Four brave ATF agents died. And I think the people need to know what happened. I think we owe it to them to tell the people. We as a Congress are on trial here. We have to be credible to the people, because if we're not credible to the people about the oversight of agencies, government agencies, then who is? Who's going to do it? Are we going to listen to the press? Are we going to be guided by the media? Are we going to leave it to our friends across the aisle who have been demonizing us since January the 4th? I think not. I listened to what went on here today. I listened to Mr. Bassett talk about the intelligence breakdown, and I agree with you 1,000%. It was rotten. I tend to think nobody even considered and consulted the intelligence reports. I'd like to have been a fly on the wall at that meeting as far as tactics are concerned. Sure, it could have been done better. I'm not too sure that it didn't start out as a fait accompli to create an assault on Waco. I think there may be different mentality in ATF from the people at the top in Washington to those street agents. I can guarantee you, from working with street agents and for being in this business, if you took a whole group of street agents together and put them in a room, they'd have come out with a reason and a way to get into that compound. The problem is we don't listen to them. The problem is we didn't listen to the Sheriff's Department or the Texas Rangers. We just did what we thought brought high profile, in my opinion, and I condemn that.
Thank you.
But we're here. I see I'm out of time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
It's all right, Mr. Hyneman. You always finish the last comment when I warn anybody. I'll tell that to any of the panelists. I'm not here to cut you off. Mr. Barr, you're recognized if you wish it for 5 minutes.
Well, I think Mr. Ehrlich is the one who wants to go. It doesn't matter at this point which order it's in, but Mr. Ehrlich, you may be recognized, I think, by some understanding over there for 5 minutes.
And I will yield to Mr. Shattuck, Mr. Chairman.
I thank my colleague for yielding to me and appreciate him being willing to surrender this time. I want to follow up an issue. You gentlemen bring us a great deal of expertise, and I'd like to tap that to discuss an issue that bothers me deeply. Several of you have discussed intelligence. Let me ask you all, you all believe that intelligence is vitally important to an operation of this type. Am I correct about that? And I take it you would all pursue, and that was, I guess, was an affirmative nod by all of them, you would all pursue every opportunity at gathering intelligence that was open to you if you could, wouldn't you? You certainly would do that before using a dynamic entry procedure of this type, I presume. Is that correct? Is there anybody that disagrees, you says no, you wouldn't pursue intelligence? There was some disturbing testimony that came out yesterday, at least disturbing to me, that suggested that although the ATF had been offered an opportunity to have an agent go inside the compound and inspect these weapons, and I just to quickly summarize it, Mr. McMahon, the gun dealer, was being interviewed by Mr. Aguilera, the ATF agent in charge. Mr. Aguilera was there in Mr. McMahon's home, which was his licensed premises. They were asking him routine questions. McMahon, unbeknownst to them, goes to the phone and calls David Koresh and says, I've got these agents here. They're concerned. They're raising some questions. What should I tell them? And Koresh says, well, tell them to come see me. And McMahon goes to Agent Aguilera and says, I've got David Koresh on the phone right now. He would like to talk to you, and he would like to extend you an offer to come over and look at the weapons he has at his location. Mr. Aguilera declined that offer, said no, he didn't want to do that at that time. I can understand, as a former assistant attorney general, why an agent wouldn't want this happenstance to dictate the point in time when you take up such an offer. What disturbs me, and what I want to ask you about, and I want each of you to individually answer, is in later testimony we established that Agent Aguilera gave that information to a supervisor. He told his supervisor that yes, in this conversation, Mr. Koresh had offered to allow Mr. Aguilera and his companion who was there with him, an accompanying agent, to go to the compound and to look at all the weapons present in the compound and inspect them and make whatever assertions they need to make with regard to firearms violations. Agent Aguilera declined it at the time. What troubles me is that at no time between when that conversation occurred did anyone in the ATF ever go back to Mr. McMahon and say, gee, can you call David Koresh and ask him if we now can come in and look at the weapons? They didn't call Mr. Koresh themselves and say, you once made an offer of saying we can come in and look at the operations. They did absolutely nothing ever, right up until the point where they walk up to the front door with their guns and conduct and carry out the dynamic entry, which results in the tragic death of several agents and the deaths of some people on the inside, and later ultimately leads to the deaths of everybody involved. They never once followed up on that offer, never even tried to follow up on that offer. Now, Mr. Sanders, let me ask you, do you believe that was proper? Can you imagine where a circumstance under which you would not even attempt to take up such an offer?
I can't imagine any circumstances that I would not take up such an offer. It indicates to me not a willingness to accept the terms of Koresh's when to go out there, but it indicates a mindset that perhaps it was non-willful. Perhaps what the ATF thought were violations of the law were really things that Mr. Koresh thought were legal.
Suggests perhaps that what they really wanted to do was to conduct a raid, not make an arrest or conduct a search.
Unfortunately, and I think that's what Mr. Iman has just stated, that these were not agents that planned that.
Mr. Ishimoto, there's nothing in the UR report or the Treasurer's report about this issue. I find that surprising.
Okay. Would you rephrase the question, sir?
I guess I'd like to know, is there a circumstance under which you would not even take up such an offer, not even try to take it up? And I also find it surprising that it's not, that this discussion isn't in your report. Perhaps you didn't know it.
I did not know about that offer that was made. I believe that was inadvertent. I would have taken it up either from an intelligence gathering standpoint or from an investigative standpoint.
Chief?
I'm a civilian, sir. I covered that, I believe, on page B87, where I indicated the Bureau's activities, expectations, and daily performance of personnel appear to have exceeded the ability of the existing management and organization structure to properly audit, inspect, supervise, and manage. I was not aware of the particular information that you're giving, that you have presented here today. I don't think that that would have substantially changed my comment. This is an example, if in fact that occurred in the context as it was presented here, that is an example of a management follow-up responsibility in the investigative caseload. A decision should have been made at some point to seek closure on that, either by policy, by procedure, by legal restriction, we cannot take up this offer, or we will do it at some point down the line and put a tickler on that until there is closure on it. That's part of investigative case management. In major cities and small cities both, you have clue chasing. You resolve each and every clue as it comes to you. And that's an example if it occurred in that context as you presented it.
Mr. Kuntz, would you do a drug investigation and not take up such an offer?
Well, sir, I don't have the information available to Agent Aguilera and or his supervisor, and I would suggest that the people that could best answer that question are Agent Aguilera and his supervisor.
Mr. Shattuck, your time has been up.
And not
thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Collins, you have come in, and it's certainly your turn if you'd like to have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me say that the focus of this panel has been the inadequate planning for the raid, and I'd like for each of the panelists to indicate the time frame that they were focusing on, please. Mr. Ishimoto, particularly, and then Mr. Morrison.
Our review extended from the initial opening of the investigation approximately in May 92 up until the events that transpired on March 2nd, where ATF turned over the jurisdiction to the FBI.
Mr. Morrison?
That's my understanding.
That's your understanding as well. Well, let me ask the both of you, too. On page 62 of the Treasury Department report on Waco, it indicates that the technical planners developed their plan in accordance with the ATF National Response Plan, which defines objectives, policies, and procedures. So the question to each of you would be whether there are any changes to the National Response Plan that should be made in order to ensure a better coordinated response and rapid deployment of ATF resources. Mr. Morrison?
I believe that that's already covered in our previous report.
Mr. Ishimoto?
It was our recommendation that the National Response Plan was a good first step, but was certainly in great need of improvement.
How would you improve it?
By expanding upon it and...
How would you expand upon it?
Through the inclusion of appropriate policy and procedures, which would be very extensive and for me to get into. But it was a shell. It was a shell of a plan. It was a step in the right direction. But there were any number of cleanup actions that needed to be done to improve it.
The success of the ATF's planned raid was predicated on the Davinian men being in the pit at 10 o'clock in the morning, as I understand it. Yet, as the Treasury report makes clear on page 64, this assumption was not communicated to the undercover agents. And it seems to me that this failure of communication was a fundamental problem in the raid planning process because it led to inadequate intelligence gathering. So the question is what were the flaws in the communication process between planners and undercover agents, one, and how can they be prevented in the future? Mr. Morrison.
That would come under the, again, the case management, intelligence management, and the command and control once the raid was committed. If it is determined that there's a critical element that the men be in the pit in order to accomplish the raid, and that in fact is not occurring from information from the observations post or from the whatever intelligence can be obtained, whether it's airborne assessment or the observation post, that needs to be conveyed to the tactical leaders immediately so that they can determine whether this will cause them to abort the mission or whether they can safely proceed. If the men are not in the pit, and that is a consideration, then where are the men and what danger do they pose?
So would you say that was part of the flaw, was there a flaw in the communications there?
There was difficulty in communications throughout. The communications net as used the day of the raid was not adequately tested and had time lags because of the relay system. That was not compensated for, in my personal opinion, by organizational mitigation. So the communication system was inadequate and it was not covered in the operational plan.
Is that your finding also, Mr. Ishimoto?
I guess from my viewpoint, the long-range fix lies in training and for the crisis managers in the ATF to understand how they can communicate better and the critical elements for success that need to be identified. Last but not least, the appropriate training would then lead to the right kinds of questions that could have been asked. For example, it is my understanding that Mr. Sherriban asked of Agent Rodriguez, do you see anybody in the windows and do you see anybody getting ready? And a better question in hindsight that could have been asked would have been, do you see the men in the pit? And is everything as we expected?
I yield the remaining time, Mr. Taylor.
I thank the gentlewoman, and before this panel is dismissed, I just want to ask you each one question. Is anything that you've seen or heard or read about the raid on February 28th justify in your minds the death of four ATF agents and the wounding of 20 more by David Koresh and his followers?
No.
Absolutely not.
No, sir.
No.
The question is, does anyone justify the deficit?
I can't hear you, sir. The mic is not on.
Mr. Sanders, am I being asked to repeat the question?
I'm sorry. No, I just wanted to clarify the question, sir. The question is whether anything justified the killing of four BATF agents?
Anything that you're experts on this subject, anything that you've seen or heard or read, does it justify the killing of four ATF agents and wounding of 20 more by David Koresh and his followers?
Nothing that I can imagine would justify that.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, Mr.
Thank you, Mr. Collins. Your time is up. Mr. Barr, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Sanders, if I could recap a couple of things before asking you a couple of questions. You have well over two decades of experience in law enforcement.
Yes, sir. I was with ATF for 24 years.
Okay. Are you very familiar then with ATF procedures?
Very much so. I was involved in practically all policies and procedures,
okay,
which are still in effect.
Are you familiar with a shooting review?
Yes, I am, sir.
Okay. Is that the mechanism that goes into place where there has been an incident involving the discharge of firearms in an ATF operation?
Every time a firearm is discharged, the shooting review team
is sent out. Is the purpose of that shooting review to determine what happened, if there were any problems, and if so, to identify those problems so they can be corrected?
It's to initially get out there as fast as possible to learn the facts, lock in the facts.
To preserve evidence?
Yes, sir.
Okay. In your experience, if there were directives from the Department of the Treasury to ATF and from the Department of Justice to ATF to not interview witnesses, to cease the gathering of evidence, to make sure that the gathering of that evidence is put off as long as possible so the witnesses' memories dim, and so that in those instances where interviews have to take place, no notes be kept so that no exculpatory or damaging information can be obtained, is that proper procedure?
That would be interference with a criminal investigation or obstruction of justice.
Okay. I would ask you to take a look, if you would, please, if I could have one of our clerks hand you some documents here. These were discussed yesterday. And I know that we won't have time in a couple of minutes here for you to review them exhaustively, but one of the documents dated March 1st of 1993, actually the document is dated September 17th, but it refers to a March 1st meeting specifically referencing the shooting review, and there is notes in there. This is a Department of the Treasury document in which the Assistant U.S. Attorney is advising Hartnett to stop the ATF shooting review. There's another document that you'll see there dated April 14th, a Treasury document which says the Department of Justice does not want Treasury to conduct any interviews or have discussions with any participants who may be potential witnesses. And then later on, there is the reference that I mentioned earlier about hoping the passage of time will dim memories. The prosecutors being concerned about developing anything negative, even preliminarily. You'll see a memo dated April 9th, 1993, in which again, with the Treasury Department coming from their Deputy General Counsel, references Department of Justice prosecutors saying words critical of ATF must be avoided. And then you'll also see some handwritten notes, which are less clear, certainly, since they're handwritten notes, than these official documents that I've referenced earlier. Would this, in your mind, raise the specter of, at best, a disinclination on the part of the administration to see that the facts come out and to do a proper shooting review, and at worst, a deliberate effort to make sure that the facts do not come out?
Yes, I agree with both.
In your experience, in your years with the Treasury, have you ever seen anything like that?
No, I haven't, sir.
Thank you. I yield back the balance of my time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Barr. I see no one on my left who hasn't had an opportunity. Mr. Bryant?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Let me reiterate what Mr. Shabbat has said, that no one on this side, and I'm sure on the other side, would condone what Mr. Koresh was doing out there in terms of abusing children, and certainly no one would condone the reaction of the Branch Davidians in firing back on lawful officers out there to serve a warrant, whether it was the worst warrant in the world or not. Again, the way to challenge those is in the courts, as was said yesterday, and not with bullets. But on the other hand, if you objectively review what has gone on out there in the what I call the two dynamic raids, would have to be judged totally unsuccessful. Four ATF agents killed and 20 wounded in the first time, and then 70 to 80 civilians, women and children, elderly, killed in the second raid. So we have to, as a Congress, look at this action. And you have to wonder about the actions of the ATF, which is our job here in Congress to oversee, not Mr. Koresh, but the acts of the ATF and their bosses at the Department of Treasury, and even into the White House and this administration, who ultimately is in control of the ATF through the Department of Treasury. So that's why we're entitled to look at these records. One has to also question why Mr. Koresh was not caught outside the compound or lured outside the compound. Being the charismatic type leader he was, one has to think that his absence from the compound would make it much more easier to immediately serve a search warrant after he was arrested and taken downtown. One has to wonder these things, and also we have to wonder about when the element of surprise was gone, why the raid went ahead notwithstanding. As I mentioned yesterday, I am still concerned deeply about what was the necessity, what was the compelling reason that the ATF had to make this first dynamic raid on that particular day, again, particularly when the element of surprise was lost. And as a former U.S. attorney, as Mr. Barr is, I know Mr. Bassett as a former FBI agent, Mr. Sanders as a former ATF agent, I'd probably like to lay some cards on the table. We're all aware very much of the interagency rivalry that exists, particularly with the FBI among other law enforcement agencies, and I think the turf battles that were out there with ATF and the FBI, and oftentimes, very frankly, who could get the most jackets out there on the scene for the cameras, whether they were ATF on the back or whether they were FBI on the back. And in light of the circumstances that existed at this time frame, where the Department of Justice had no attorney general, the FBI, who was under the Department of Justice, had Judge Sessions, who was under attack at that point for alleged misconduct, and the ATF had a director at that time, Mr. Benson, and this was their action. I wonder if any of these circumstances, any of this inter-agency rivalry came into play, the effect of an impending budget. There was talk in those days of doing away with the ATF, of merging it with FBI. Was there a need, Mr. Sanders, at that point, if you know, for the ATF to have this type of dynamic entry, this type of show that perhaps at some level in the chain of command, whether it was in Washington or in Texas, may have justified the need to go in on that day, February the 28th, 1993, in the manner that they chose?
I think I can best answer that. I spoke with a number of agents who were still on the job following the aborted raid of Waco. The general impression that I got was that this was something that was forced on the field by headquarters, by the bosses. Just prior to that, there was much evidence that this was a very troubled agency.
Very troubled agency?
Very troubled agency.
Would you speak so that everyone can hear you a little closer to the microphone?
Yes, sir. The agents themselves, I think, are just great. You should have a ticker tape parade for them. They're splendid. They're fine. They're the best there is. But there was evidence of a very troubled agency. For one, in October, some of the very fine black agents had filed a class action suit charging that they had been discriminated against in work assignments, in discipline, in the very oppressive nature of the job. In January of 1992, 60 Minutes did a nationwide broadcast of sexual harassment. Waco came between that and the appropriations hearings, which were scheduled in early March.
Were part of those 60 minutes sexual harassment allegations, did they come out of this particular office in Texas or its immediate supervisor?
I really don't know. They were basically all over the country sexual harassment cases which were brought to the view of the nation, and ATF and the director of ATF looked like a fool in those hearings. So that was present. And, you know, in the opinion of the agents, this the planning for Waco and the manner in which it was done was done for the purpose of publicity.
Mr. Sanders, we've been asked to clarify what you said October. What year were you referring to?
That was October 92.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Bryant. I think the only other person left is Mr. Blut. Mr. Blut, you're recognized for 5 minutes if you wish.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. At this time, I would yield my time to the gentleman from Indiana, Mr. Booyer.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Blut. I have just a few brief questions quickly. Mr. Ishimoto, in your report, you talked about the inexperience in crisis management operating planning skills for a large-scale operation such as Waco was clearly evident in the planning and execution of the raid. Now, as I understand from your experience, you were a commander with the Iran hostage back in the late 70s, or was that correct?
In 1980, sir.
In 1980. Were you the commander of that operation that took them into the desert?
No, sir. I was the intelligence officer, but I had command of a road security team. Okay.
But as I understand, with a lot of different operations, that there are go, no-go procedures, are there not?
Yes, sir.
And with regard to that hostage rescue for which you were involved with, for which America is also fully informed of, there was a no-go procedure, that being that if you went under six helicopters, it was a no-go, and that there were six helicopters that landed in the desert, one had hydraulic problems, and there was a call to a no-go, and you aborted the mission, and then as they began to fly off, we had the crash, and everything happened afterwards. Is that?
That's correct, sir.
So go, no-go procedures. In your review, did ATF, and they're participating in this close combat support, did they have go, no-go procedures?
Yes, sir, but I'm looking for the appropriate words. I'll just call them unsophisticated variety, and they didn't address the right things to look for to make it a go. For example, finding the men working outside and getting a report either from Kavanaugh or Rodriguez that that situation was in existence.
An unsophisticated variety. That's very tactful. You're being very tactful today. In your report, you weren't as tactful because you said their lack of contingency plan basically was, quote, an oh shit plan. Isn't that basically what you?
Those were the words
like,
that were given
run
to
from
us.
The building, yes, take cover. Oh shit, it's coming.
Could I expand on my comments
please,
a little
go
bit?
Ahead.
Okay.
I mean, I know what a no go is. If it turns into oh my god, yeah. That's.
Those were the words that were given to us, and but I recall one of the last times I saw Mr. Bassett, it was prior to the FBI having a hostage rescue team.
Yeah. Do we have to make
a your point, please?
We have to make a warning to the children of America that profanity is being used here the way we did yesterday?
I don't see any exploitation of children right now, so.
But I go back to 1981, where the FBI at that point in time, there were some in their administration that did not believe that they needed a hostage rescue team. At a particular exercise, Mr. Bassett found out about a baloney bomb and found out what go, no-go situations could have meant on the side of the FBI, who was using a regional SWAT concept. Now, fortunately, they were able to determine the need for a more sophisticated operation like the HRT, and unfortunately, the ATF did not have that opportunity in training.
All right. See, what is so vitally important about these hearings, and why these hearings are important to strengthen law enforcement, is that when we have those who are operating in the field that will save life. And part of that also is contingency plannings and operations. Is that correct, sir?
Yes, sir.
And when we have such the words that you use, that the unsophisticated forms of variety of plans that are never written, there is a lack of confidence. And I think we need to make sure that when we have plans in the future, that we have that strength in the law enforcement, that our officers in the field are confident that their supervisors are making good judgment decisions. Would you agree with that, sir?
Yes, sir, and that's why I placed emphasis in my report on the need for improved training.
So, let me make sure I'm confident on this. There were no, as you're aware, there weren't any no-go procedures.
There were go, no-go procedures. Okay. They talked about if they were compromised, what would happen. Okay. They talked about if they fully believe that they lost the element of surprise, then they should back off.
Last question. Who in Washington had the authority to call off the raid?
I didn't hear the last part.
Who in Washington had the authority to call off the raid under a no-go procedure?
I think ranging from the director, Mr. Higgins, at that point in time, to down through Mr. Hartnett, both of them certainly had that authority, as well as Mr. Winowski and Sarabin in the field.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate your answer.
Thank you very much. Ms. Slaughter, you've come in. Would you like 5 minutes?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're recognized.
Thank you very much. Gentlemen, I know that you are the hindsight team. What you think might have been done a little bit better, and I'm sure there were many things that could have been. But I want to ask you again a very simple question, and it is this. Has anything that you've seen or heard or read about this raid given you any idea that there is justification for the killing of 4 ATF officers by David Koresh and his followers?
Ma'am, Mr. Taylor asked a similar question and our response.
I'm sorry, I was out of the room with a constituent, but I'd like to hear it again. In there with me.
Resounding no.
Well, it's easier for us, and the rest of you agree that there is nothing in law at any point that when law officials of the government come to the door, is there any grounds whatever on which the person inside that door in that building has the right to shoot legal officers doing their duty? Well, I think I'd like to talk to you about another thing about the growing militarization, which obviously is a big problem here. Isn't it true that the amount of firepower and sophisticated weaponry and the arsenals that criminals have now and psychopaths like David Koresh require you to use everything at your disposal to try to fight that kind of menace?
I guess my response would be ATF, as well as other law enforcement, tries to use the appropriate amount of force. In other words, certainly nobody considered strafing the compound with a F-16 fighter or ramming it with bulldozers, if not tanks, on February the 28th. That would not have been a judicious use of force, but certainly would have gotten the mission accomplished in some ways.
Well, the chain of activity seems to be that the local law enforcement asked the ATF to come in. And I know that one of our bones of contention is, did the ATF ask the Department of Defense to come in because of the methamphetamine lab? Is it your opinion, all of you, that there was no evidence there of that laboratory?
Yes.
Yes.
There was nothing there to justify the use of the higher military power.
Ms. Slaughter,
yes, I'd like to hear that answer.
Yes, my knowledge in that regard is limited to what I've read in the Treasury report, but I'm aware of no evidence of narcotics being present.
Let me yield for a moment to my colleague from New York, Mr. Schumer.
I thank the gentlelady, and I'd just like to make one other point related to, this was a search warrant, so you had to go to the grounds. Serving a warrant off the premises wouldn't make much sense. Do you agree with that, Mr. Ishimoto?
Yes. In hindsight, we knew, ATF now knows that Koresh was leaving the compound, but at that time, they did not know that factually,
exactly.
Therefore.
And second, there's a lot of talk of why dynamic entry rather than siege was used. The siege approach was used. In reference to a question someone on the other side asked, you had explained briefly, and I'd like to give you another opportunity to go over that, both Mr. Ishimoto and Mr. Morrison, our experts here, who looked at the report. Would you please explain why siege, when planning this raid, would not be the preferred method?
The ATF was very much concerned with the previous incident where they, in conjunction with the FBI, sieged the Covenant Sword and Armor of the Lord compound in Arkansas, and a considerable amount of evidence was destroyed, subsequently resulting in a lesser amount of...
And they were criticized for that, right?
Yes.
Could I reclaim my time just before it's up, please, Chuck? Because I want to get back again to the serving of the search warrant. It is all of your judgment, and particularly Mr. Morrison, who is also himself in law enforcement, that a search warrant needs to be served on the premises that have to be served. If you were to serve the person who was responsible for those premises outside, let's say while he's jogging in the street, he has the opportunity to go home and destroy the evidence that you may be searching for.
That's basically the difference between an arrest warrant and a search warrant. The purpose here is to seize evidence of illegal activity. In this case, it was
and
quite well
established. And that was the purpose of trying to serve the search warrant, was it not?
Yes.
Thank you.
Your time is up, and Mr. Sauter, you're in. Mr. If you'd like, 5 minutes.
Thank you.
You're recognized.
Yield, 1 minute to Mr. Barr.
Thank you. Mr. Sanders, if I could just follow up on our discussion previously. After looking at those memos, and I would further draw your attention to the fact that one of the agents who was fired, terminated, and then rehired as part of the rehiring of that agent, there was a settlement reached between the government and attorneys for the for former agent and now current agent. And as part of that settlement, the settlement specifically requires that files be destroyed. Now, presumably, these relate to the matters we were talking about earlier, the shooting review, what went wrong, and so forth. And I just want to make sure that in the context we're talking about here, you, I think, mentioned the possibility of this raising, in your mind, an obstruction of justice charge with regard to directives not to gather evidence, not to take notes, not to conduct interviews, as part of the government's effort in the aftermath of the initial shooting.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I just wanted to clarify that. I agree with you. Thank you. And I yield back my time to Mr. Sauter.
I yield 1 minute to the chair, Mr. Sauter.
Thank you for yielding. In my line of questioning to all of you as to whether there was a drug connection or not, I just want to add one last thing, if I could, and introduce Mr. Chairman into the evidence here. A document that is actually the operational order to give, put out by the Pentagon to give the Department of Defense assistance. And I refer to the second page particularly. The suspect group is an extremist cult survivalist organization. Intelligence indicates an active methamphetamine lab and deliveries of required chemicals to produce the synthetic methamphetamines. This is the operational order to give DOD assistance, and I appreciate your expert opinions in terms of whether there was or was not a drug connection. I'd just like to submit this for evidence.
Without objection, it will so received. Mr. Sauter has the time.
I said without objection.
Well, everything is received into evidence here.
Unanimous consent, so therefore
sure.
I will ask for clarification.
Sure. Reserving the right to object, you are recognized.
Reserving the right to object, I would ask for a clarification. Is this a DOD order? Or was this a Texas National Guard order, since these were Texas National Guard aircraft?
This was a fair question. This was a DOD order.
Thank you very much.
Operator, I just given a copy to Mr. Schumer.
Without objection, it is admitted. Mr. Sauter, you still have time.
Okay. With that, I'll yield the balance of my time to Mr. Shattuck.
Mr. Shattuck?
Thank you very much. I have a very brief time here. Mr. Ishimoto, you made a point earlier that there was a review process in the Department of Defense for determining if there is a drug nexus, that it was used in this case, and that the Department of Defense has standards. I think there are some doubts about the evidence that was given to the Department of Defense. I just want to know if you find it upsetting that they may have been misled, and if you are aware of a memo written by the Department of Defense, by the Army, dated 9 September 1993, where in discussing this, I'm referring to the Waco instance. They say, in that instance, we, meaning the United States Army, were persuaded to provide BATF free training with the allegation, never confirmed, proven, or even acknowledged, that it was for, quote, suspected, for a, quote, suspected methamphetamine laboratory.
Sir, would you accept a suggestion on my part that you follow those questions up with the military people that are going to...
I fully intend to do that. It appears to me they were seriously misled, and that's what they're saying here.
Okay, and I have problems with that because I'm not... I am convinced that ATF did not do the misleading, that these were, in fact, people internal to the military and to the Texas governor's office.
This suggests there were. Mr. Bassett, let me turn to you. You didn't get a chance to answer my earlier question. I had asked, is there ever a circumstance in which, when you'd been offered a chance to gather intelligence by having an agent go inside a location where you wanted to make an arrest and conduct a search, you'd been offered that where you wouldn't make any attempt to take up that offer, as apparently occurred here?
I can't think of any situation like that, no.
Thank you very much. I yield back the balance of my time.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Shadegg and Mr. Sauter. We are now, I think, complete, having gone through the five-minute rule for everybody who wished to take 5 minutes, who are members of either of these two joint panels. I want to thank the witnesses on this particular panel here today. You have endured quite a period of time, but your contribution is very important to helping the public and us understand the entire process at Waco. Mr. Bassett?
Mr. McCollum, may I have the opportunity to make a very short statement that is directly relevant to both the Treasury and the Justice Department?
Yes, you may.
I will
yield you that opportunity.
Thank you, sir. I've reduced it to writing to minimize the time. Both the Treasury and Justice Department reviews of the Waco incident have contained recommendations concerning the need for both ATF and FBI to improve their procedures for eliciting advice from outside experts. Shortly after the Waco event, an informal affiliation of academics, professionals, and former senior government officials, known as the Critical Incident Analysis Group, formed at Michigan State University. The group's intent is to conduct collaborative analysis of significant incidents, enrich public discussion of crisis events, and assist crisis managers when possible. Last year, the FBI expressed an interest in our group, resulting in an ongoing exploration with the newly formed Crisis Incident Response Group of the FBI, focusing on the feasibility of developing university-based advisory groups which can support the FBI and potentially other law enforcement agencies with a network of known, highly qualified consultants in future complex incidents such as Waco. In our efforts thus far, we've enlisted some very distinguished Americans who have volunteered to assist in this effort, and we're very optimistic that a workable advisory network can be established which will enhance FBI and potentially other law enforcement capability. Realizing the time constraints on this committee, I would request permission from the committee to assemble materials providing an overview of our progress to date for later consideration and inclusion in the hearing record.
We're very glad to receive that, Mr. Bassett. And I want to thank all the members of the panel for coming here today and being with us. We are now going to be in recess until 2:15, or 5 minutes thereafter, pending any vote that might be on at the time. Mr. Barr, before we recess.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, could I ask unanimous consent that the documents that Mr. Sanders reviewed, which I handed him, either be included in the record today or referenced as those that I included in the record
without
yesterday.
Objection. So ordered.
Thank you.
The subcommittee's jointly meeting now will be in recess until 2:15.
Watching the second day of Waco hearings before the House Joint Oversight and Judiciary Subcommittee. We'll return in a moment, but first some program information. Our companion network, C-SPAN 2, welcomes 15,000 new subscribers at Paragon Cable of Ilion, New York. Paragon joins cable companies all across the country, adding C-SPAN 2 to their systems.